How do we get United Airlines to drag our new Supreme Court Justice Neil Gorsuch out of his seat? It's 3 a.m. Friday, April 14th, 2017. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show. Let's get right to it. On today's show, wow, comedians, Dom Irrera, Kira Soltanovich, and Alonzo Bodden. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, and also check out Pay What You Want. Alex Brazil, my executive producer, the executive producer of this show, the owner of Showbriz Studios, he got Jeremy. He's a great editor. Anyway, they're working on a live comedy album for me, for us, for you. And you can hear the first 10 minutes of my new comedy album by going to my website, and you pay what you want to hear Pay What You Want. That's the name of the album, Pay What You Want. We'll have it up, I don't know, around Thanksgiving. So please pay what you want. We're doing another live taping of this podcast at QED in Astoria Saturday at 7:30 on April 29th. This is going to be great. Sean Donnelly, Pat Dixon are already on the bill. We're still adding to it. Maybe Jackie the Joke Man will come and do it again. He did our last live show at QED in Astoria. And tickets are only $8 to see a live taping of The David Feldman Show. For more information, please go to QEDAstoria.com. That's the letter Q as in queef, E as in erectile dysfunction, D as in dad ain't right, Astoria, A as in Astoria, S as in so you're going to keep doing the stupid bit, T as in teabagging, O as in, oh my God, David Feldman is a cretin, I as in, you know, I was going to go see David at QED in Astoria on the 29th of April, but now I've changed my mind. A as in autoerotic asphyxiation. Oh, God. Anyway, live. That's QEDAstoria.com. You should check out that website despite me. And go to QEDAstoria.com to find out more information about the live taping of The David Feldman Show, April 29th. Tickets are $8. The show starts at 7 p.m. That's S as... No, okay. 7 p.m. Astoria, Queens. If you're... Sorry. If you're visiting New York, trust me, get on the N train. I think it's the N train. It'll take you to Astoria. It's the last stop on the N train. And one of the greatest subway rides in New York because it's above ground. Get to see the entire skyline of Manhattan. The subway is less than $3. Tickets to see a live taping of The David Feldman Show, $8. $11 to come out to Astoria to see a live taping of my podcast. And you can walk around Astoria. Some of the greatest Greek restaurants in the world. Are in Astoria because there are so many Greeks in Astoria. It's actually called Astoria. That's how many Greeks there are in Astoria. It's really called Astoria because of the Greeks. So if you know anybody who lives in Astoria, then call them up and say, hey, Alexandros, you live in Astoria. Go see a live taping of David Feldman's podcast at QED on April 29th. Tickets are just $8. Or go to QEDAstoria.com. That's Q as in queef, E as in erectile dysfunction, D as in that ain't right, A, okay, QEDAstoria.com, and buy the tickets for your friend as a gift. Here's why. Let's say you live in California. Give this as a gift. Go to QEDAstoria.com. $8. You can give a gift to a friend who lives in New York. They can come see a live taping of the show. And here's why. You are supporting my favorite club, QED, and my favorite people in the world, Christian Finnegan. This is an amazing comedian. He opened this club with his amazing wife, Cambry, and it's a gym for stand-up comedians. And every time I walk in there, I want to be a stand-up comic. And you need to support QED because it's what a comedy club should be. And remember how Barry Crimmins on Tuesday's show was talking about the novel idea of treating comedians with respect? Well, New York is a tough town for comics, and QED is our oasis. It's a home for lost souls who have nothing in their life other than making people laugh. So get your ass out to Astoria and come see a live taping of my podcast at QED on the 29th of April. That's a Saturday. We start the show at 7:30. We're going to have a lot of surprise guests. I want to sell this show out. So please, I don't ask for much. Go to QED Astoria, $8 for tickets. Go to QEDAstoria.com. Let me help you out because you may not know how to spell QED Astoria. So it's the letter Q as in queef, E as in erectile dysfunction, and D as in that ain't right, Astoria as in Astoria, S as in, okay, we'll be right back. Flew on United yesterday. Did you know that they charge an extra $75 if you want to be dragged out of your seat by your legs? This is what everyone's upset about. This doctor who got yanked, that got pulled out of the airplane. Shouldn't we be worrying about not who's being pulled out of our airplanes, but what's being dropped out of our airplanes, like in Afghanistan or Syria? I mean, we are killing innocent civilians, but that's all we talk about, the good doctor who got dragged out of his seat by security guards working for United. It's horrible. I know. It's horrible. But, you know, when you fly, you make a covenant with the airlines that you're going to be obedient and do what you're told. I know the guy was a doctor. He got roughed up. But pick your battles. The airlines are in charge. Of course they're wrong. So get off the plane and then make a stink. Don't make a stink inside the plane. It already stinks enough. Just leave. Don't make them drag you off the jet. You're flying. It's an indignity. You're flying coach. Surrender. You lost. Part of the allure of flying is that you have to surrender. It's kind of like why I enjoy flying. You have zero control. It's one of the few moments. It's one of the few periods in your life when you have to accept that you have no control. I'm a control freak. And being forced to just completely abandon everything, embrace it. Pick your battles. You're a doctor. I get it. You like to be in control, but pick your battles. You're about to be launched an aluminum tube hurtling 650 miles an hour. 30,000 feet in the air, you know, one disruptive passenger can kill people. So, you know, we all have to do what we're told. It's not fair. Flying is an insult. We bailed out the airlines after 9/11 and they returned the favor by charging us for a pillow. I get it. But do what you're told. Even a doctor, I'm sorry, but even a doctor has to answer to a flight attendant. Give up your seat. Embrace flying because it's the great equalizer. Nobody's better than anybody else. We all have to just sit in our seats and take it. Just take it. Just pick your battles. Speaking of battles, Donald Trump is saying if he can do a better job killing people overseas than he can killing them in America by passing the Republican health care bill. Sean Spicer defended Donald Trump's attack on Syria by saying that even Hitler didn't use chemical weapons on his own people. In all fairness, what Sean Spicer meant by Hitler not using chemical weapons on his own people is, I needed a job and nobody else would hire me, so just pretend I should be here. Okay? After that, the military unleashed the mother of all bombs on Afghanistan. Not sure dropping Sherry Lansing on ISIS is going to really accomplish anything. Sherry Lansing was the head of Paramount, and she was replaced, I think, by Brad Gray because she was responsible for bombs. So that would be, that would make her a mother of all bombs, like that joke. Sean Spicer said the mother of all bombs, I don't know if you saw, you probably saw on CNN, Moab. Sean Spicer said Moab was necessary on Thursday in order to draw attention away from what a dismal job Donald Trump is doing domestically. When Spicer said Trump dropped the mother of all bombs, I thought he meant Steve Bannon was finally fired. Quite a week for Trump. He fired missiles at Syria. Now he's dropping bombs on Afghanistan, and he's keeping his promise to bomb the quote-unquote shit out of ISIS. Well, this past week, I gained a little insight into Donald Trump. We've always talked on this show how it's impossible to plumb the depths of this man's depravity and his insanity. We can't understand his need to be surrounded by sycophants, even members of his own family, who will tell him whatever he wants to hear as if their job depends upon it, which, in fact, it does. It does depend on telling Donald everything he wants to hear. That's one of the benefits to hiring your children. They are forced to love you no matter what because you can fire them. It's pretty intoxicating. You know, I love my kids. But I know I speak for every parent. I wouldn't mind having the ability to fire my kids. Your three adult kids working for you, and they can't challenge you the way normal kids can because you're the boss? Eric, Don Jr., Ivanka, they're in their 30s, and they're still collecting their allowance. Wow. Is Ivanka in her 30s? I don't know if she's in her. Look, they're pushing 30, and they're collecting their allowance from their father. That's pretty demeaning for a child, but great for the father. If I could have swung that, oh, I would have in a second. I mean, you know, imagine walking into the dining room for Thanksgiving and all your kids suddenly get nervous because the boss just entered. We're always told friends should never go into business with each other because somebody will take advantage of the relationship, cross the line, bring emotion into it, and the business and the friendship will come crashing down. But when a father hires his three kids, and that father is a malignant narcissist like Donald Trump, man, he's got it made. He's got three employees who are permanently crippled, his three kids. They know they can't go anywhere else because anywhere else is a meritocracy, so they will definitely sink, not float. Sure, they could get a job somewhere else, but they're not going to make the kind of money that Donald pays them for their allowance. And certainly they're not going to have access to the guy in charge the way they do now. That's what being the son of the boss gets you. The great thing for Trump is having his three idiot kids working for him, so he gets to conflate love with money. That's what malignant narcissists do. Malignant narcissists, like Donald Trump, live for conflating love with money. Donald Trump gets zero back talk from his kids. Think about that. Do you have kids? Think about what that's like, to have your kids pretend to worship you. Having somebody pretend to worship you versus somebody actually worshiping you, I don't see the difference. You can pretend to worship me or just worship me. I'll take either one. His kids worship him because if they have a falling out, which most fathers and children have, it goes with the territory, then, you know, if they have a falling out, then Eric, Don Jr., Ivanka, they have to actually work for a living and they have to deal with real bosses who probably don't want to adopt them. It's really not what you're supposed to do. You know, you're not supposed to hire your children. I mean, if you're not a malignant narcissist, you shouldn't hire your children, because the problem with hiring your own kids is they lose out on probably the most important lesson when it comes to getting through life. When you work for a living, when you are forced to go out and make your own way, it forces you to compromise. When you don't have your parents to fall back on, one of the things you learn quickly is how to eat shit. And eating shit is really important. You not only have to learn how to eat shit, but you have to learn how to say, thank you, may I have some more shit. And then you have to ask if you can take some of the shit home in a doggy bag and eat a little more for breakfast. Eating shit is key to understanding business. Eating shit is what life is. It's what love is. It's compromise. We all have to eat shit, and we all have to remember the taste of that shit so that when we're in charge, we don't make other people eat too much shit. But everyone who wants to earn a living, everyone, you have to eat shit. That's why we need a draft in this country. You turn 18, you spend 2 years of your life eating shit. Even Donald Trump has to eat shit. And I'm not talking about what the Russian hookers make him do. If you want to succeed, pay your own bills, survive in this world, especially in America, you have to eat shit. And it's that rare bird who gets into a position of power and tries his best not to make the people below him or her eat shit. I've had some bosses who didn't make me eat shit. They preferred pissing on me. I do think there are bosses in this world, or business partners in this world, or lovers, who really go out of their way not to make you eat shit. But you should still learn how to eat shit. You should learn what shit tastes like, so you know the indignity of eating shit, and you know that only a sadist enjoys making other people eat shit, and you should do everything in your life not to make people eat shit. You cannot know that forcing somebody to eat shit is abusive unless you've tasted shit. Don Jr., Eric, and Ivanka, they don't eat shit. They've never tasted shit. Ivanka doesn't eat shit. She doesn't eat anything, because in order for the brand to exist, she has to be anorexic. So how did I gain insight into my, I'm not going to say president. How did I gain insight into Donald? Well, this week, for some reason, my friends and family were nice to me. I don't know why. They probably need something. Nobody in my immediate family or my friends, for some reason this week, they didn't complain about my clothes, my driving, the breadcrumbs that landed on the reading glasses around my neck during dinner. Something's up. Something's up. I know in a few days they're going to come after me. But for some reason, maybe it's spring, maybe people are in love, so they've decided to stop blaming me for all their problems. Maybe they've gotten a little older and don't have the energy to use me as a punching bag. But for some reason, I could do no wrong this week with my friends, my family, the people I work with. And that has to be what Donald Trump feels like all the time. I'm telling you, it's not bad. Donald Trump doesn't get any crap from his kids, from Melania, from the people who work for him. And I'm telling you, if you get a taste of that, it's not bad. It's not bad, but it makes me uneasy because it's too quiet. They're up to something. My kids, my friends, the people I work with, my mother, my sisters, my brothers, my nieces and nephews. It's too quiet. I know in a few days they're going to hit me with a surprise attack. Right now, I'm the United States 8th Army in South Korea, and the Chinese are secretly amassing troops along the Manchurian border and getting ready to rain down a heap of pain on me. But right now, I'll take the peace and quiet. I'll take it. My kids never went for the unconditional love thing. Probably because I didn't pay them for unconditional love the way Donald Trump does. Everything with my kids was transactional, especially the love. A few years ago, I was talking with one of my daughters and some of her friends, and I jokingly referred to Ashley Tinsdale. I think that's her name. Well, anyway, I pronounced it Ashley Dimsdale. I don't remember if I did it on purpose or not, but that's one of the things I used to do around my kids. I would say, hey, you know, are you going to go see Spider-Man with Tobey Maguire? And they would say, it's Tobey Maguire. And I would say, I know, Tobey Maguire. It's what fathers do. I can't explain it. It's just what you do. Anyway, I called Ashley Tinsdale, Ashley Dimsdale or something, and my daughter stopped talking to me for like a month because of that. Donald Trump calls Mexicans rapists. He separates mothers from children. He openly boasts about grabbing pussy. But Ivanka is still standing there singing her daddy's praises. And it's because she's on the payroll. Every daughter is disgusted by her father. But not Ivanka, because she sees a dollar sign on her father's head. You and I, we see a dead blonde possum on Donald's head. Ivanka sees a dollar sign. And she's not going to allow herself to lose her job or her allowance. It's a tough job working for Donald, especially if you're Ivanka. She's everything Donald wants in a woman, himself. He doesn't leave her alone. She's on call 24/7. Which is why listeners to my show know that last week when Meryl Marco and I were talking, we came up with the idea that Ivanka converted to Orthodox Judaism not because Jared Kushner wanted her to. She doesn't care about that schlep, Jared Kushner. No, for Ivanka, the only allure of Orthodox Judaism is the strict observance of the Sabbath. That's right. No phone on Saturday. No cars. You can't travel. You have to stay home. What does that mean? No Donald Trump. No daddy. That's what a horrible pain in the ass Donald Trump is. In order to guarantee that 1/7 of her life could be spent away from him, his own daughter, Ivanka, was forced to convert to the very last thing any normal woman would ever choose, Orthodox Judaism. From blonde Gentile to Orthodox Judaism, you're going to blow out the transmission. Nobody goes from Gentile to Orthodox Judaism unless they're hiding from someone. And that someone is her malignant narcissist of a father, Donald Trump. Do you really think she was inspired by Jared to convert to Orthodox Judaism? Trust me, Jared Kushner and his family are not the Jewish Kennedys. Granted, they're criminals like the Kennedys, but they're not the Kennedys. I could see marrying the Kennedys and converting to Roman Catholicism. And that was part of my plan in high school. I had it all figured out in high school. I figured that after I graduated from Harvard Law, I would marry Caroline Kennedy, the daughter of JFK, and the family would probably make me convert to Catholicism, but that's okay because it's the Kennedys, and it's more important that Caroline be happy because she's Caroline Kennedy, and I'm supposed to marry Caroline Kennedy. Things didn't turn out the way I planned. I like to think it's because Caroline and I never laid eyes upon each other. Looking back, I probably wasn't her type. I don't like to sail. play football, make tons of money. I'm not into that whole respectable human being who can hold his head up high in public kind of thing. That's just not my style. Anyway, Jared Kushner is not a Kennedy. Ivanka didn't convert to Orthodox Judaism to be accepted by the grand doyens of society, the Kushners. She converted to Orthodox Judaism for one reason. There's one guaranteed day a week where there's no Donald Trump. And I think most Americans would convert to Orthodox Judaism if we all could be guaranteed at least one day a week of no Donald Trump. When it comes to malignant narcissists, Donald hasn't made. Nobody questions him, not even his children. And being able to escape the scorn and ridicule of your children, that has to be intoxicating. That has to be delicious for him. For his kids, well, that's just building up inside of them. Not to be able to openly scorn and ridicule your father, that's got to make you sick. Scorn and ridicule of your father is the jet fuel that makes all of us reach for the stars. Nobody succeeds because of love. We succeed in life because we hate our fathers. I had the greatest father in the world, and I hated him. Because sons hate their fathers. Daughters hate their fathers. Not all the time, but enough. You have to hate them. It's biologically baked into your DNA to hate your father. Again, not all the time, just most of the time. Your father is an embarrassment because he's a window into your future. All those things that he does to annoy you, you're going to be doing those same exact things and you won't even realize it because that's the cycle of violence. Your father annoys you, and you annoy your children. It's the circle of life. It's the circle of wishing you were dead. Fathers are detestable because we're not interested. We say we're interested. We're not. And you know we're not interested. You can tell we're not interested because life didn't turn out the way we planned. I'm not Mrs. Caroline Kennedy. I know I didn't measure up. I'd like to enjoy your Little League game, son, but I'm not Mrs. Caroline Kennedy, and it's eating away at me. Hey, you got on base. Good for you. It bothers me. And Donald Trump is bothered by the fact that he's Donald Trump. Donald Trump isn't interested in his children or his wife or his country. He's interested in the fact that he's Donald Trump. And he has spent his entire life trying to figure out what that means. So the Trump kids, by working for their dad, have been denied that one guilty pleasure most children should enjoy. They should enjoy, they must enjoy. And that is the unbridled hatred for their father. Ivanka, Eric, and Don Jr., they can't hate their father because then they don't get their allowance. So they have to find, a workaround. Ivanka, as I said, converted to Orthodox Judaism to get that one day a week without grab ass from her father. And Eric and Don Jr. kill endangered species to sublimate their abject hatred for their father. That's how they deal with it. They go to Africa and they kill lions and zebras. No matter how much you think you hate Donald Trump, trust me, his three kids, Ivanka, Don Jr., and Eric, they hate him more than all of us combined. I mean, the man raped their mother. And the only reason she had it removed from the divorce deposition, according to the New York Times and CNN, is because she wanted a bigger payday. That's what happens when you care more about money than you do your own self-respect or laws about marital rape. I know we have Republicans controlling the White House, the Supreme Court, and both houses of Congress, but last time I checked, you're still not allowed to rape your wife. But, this is why I bring this up. In 2015, Trump's lawyer, Michael Cohen, he was a special counsel to Donald Trump and an executive vice president at the Trump Organization. He had to apologize in July of 2015 after he told the Daily Beast that legally, quote, you cannot rape your spouse. Cohen, Michael Cohen, Trump's lawyer, was defending his client against allegations that he raped his first wife, Ivanka, the mother of Ivana, Don Jr., and Eric. That's a lawyer who said you cannot rape your spouse. That's Michael Cohen, who charges Donald Trump, I don't know, let's say $1,000 an hour for his legal advice. And he thinks there's no such thing as marital rape. Because that's who Donald Trump surrounds himself with. Lawyers who take $1,000 an hour to tell Donald Trump whatever he wants to hear. No, Donald, you didn't rape your wife. Now give me $1,000. By the way, you're also not allowed to beat your wife. I don't know if you knew that, but you can't beat your wife or rape your wife. Andrew Puzder was Trump's first pick for labor secretary. He didn't get the job. He was the CEO of Carl's Jr., and then he stepped down from that job when he was nominated for labor secretary. It turns out his wife called the police several times on him because I guess she claimed he was beating her up. And in 1990, she showed up on Oprah in disguise, anonymously claiming that her husband, she didn't name him directly, she said that he would make her pay for repeatedly embarrassing him by calling the police after he allegedly punched her. Eventually, when it came down to filing charges, Andrew Puzder's first wife, she didn't file charges. She went on Oprah in disguise, but she took his money instead, because that's usually what happens in a divorce when the husband is abusive and successful. If you want to divorce a rich, physically abusive husband, you pretty much have to keep your mouth shut, because if it comes out that, say, Donald Trump, is a rapist or Andrew Puzder is a wife beater, then you're tarnishing the brand. Your ex-husband's future earnings are then jeopardized, and so these ex-husbands can't pay the alimony. That's how it works. So you usually, you know, what happened was Ivana allegedly claimed in the divorce deposition that Donald raped her, and then she walked it back because she didn't want to tarnish his image, because if Donald Trump was known as a rapist, he couldn't pay her the alimony she wanted. I bring this up because there have been a lot of bombs going off in Syria and Afghanistan the past couple of weeks. And, you know, it's impossible to plumb the depths of depravity in these people. Could you press the button to drop the mother of all bombs? I'm not saying Donald Trump is a rapist. Ivana said that, and then she retracted it. And I'm not saying his pick for labor secretary was physically abusive. Puzder's wife told Oprah that. What I'm saying is that it wouldn't surprise me if Trump raped Ivana or Andrew Puzder beat his wife. The same way it doesn't surprise me that Donald Trump would order an airstrike in Syria and Afghanistan for no other reason than looking presidential. I'm not saying he didn't kill some terrorists this week in Afghanistan. I'm saying it wouldn't bother him if the mother of all bombs also accidentally killed some innocent people, or as the military calls that, collateral damage. You don't have a second thought about the mother of all bombs because you haven't had a second thought about the mother of all your adult children and the mothers of Tiffany and Barron. I have no doubt that Donald Trump, who spent the late 70s and early 80s evicting 90-year-old women to make way for a high rise, knowing that those women would die just from being forced to move, I'm saying it wouldn't bother Donald Trump to drop bombs, to look presidential, and if a couple of innocent people have to die, so what? We do not have accurate bombs. And most of us would know this if we had an accurate media. There's no such thing as smart bombs when they're being fired by a moron like Donald Trump. For example, on Tuesday, another American airstrike in Syria killed 18 Syrian fighters who are on our side. They're fighting with us to defeat Assad. Last month, Iraqi officials and residents claimed 200 civilians died in Mosul from a U.S.-led airstrike. Lieutenant General Stephen Townsend said, after the 200 civilians in Mosul died, he said, "If we did it, and I'd say there's at least a fair chance that we did, it was an unintentional accident of war." That's what he said late last month at the Pentagon. It was an unintentional accident of war. Are we at war in Iraq? Did Congress ever declare war? Didn't we pull the troops out? Who are we fighting in Iraq? Are we paying attention? Air Wars is a British journalist-led transparency project working to collect numbers on civilian casualties caused by coalition Russian and American international airstrikes, specifically in Syria and Iraq. They analyzed data that the Pentagon has provided, as well as local newspapers on the ground, and they published news of their findings. I learned about them through the New York Times this week. They claim that by mid-March, American coalition airstrikes had killed possibly as many as 1,000 civilians in Syria and Iraq so far this year. And that's mid-March. What is that, about 10 weeks? Coalition airstrikes killed roughly 1,000 civilians in Syria and Iraq. I urge you to go to airstrikes.org and look at it. Pretty amazing. It's just coalition forces kill 3 civilians in Raqqa, 2 in Mosul in one day. It just adds up every day. It's been said the first casualty of war is the truth. The problem with Trump is the truth can't die when it's not even alive. Donald Trump is not equipped to be our commander-in-chief. We're told that he's surrounding himself with some of the Pentagon's greatest minds, you know, as David Halberstam would have called them, the best and the brightest. Kennedy and Johnson had the best and the brightest, and the best and the brightest dragged us into Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia. It cost us nearly 60,000 American lives, millions of lives of innocent people living in Indochina, not to mention the drain on our treasury. That's why we need to be protected from the best and the brightest. We need a president, a Congress who goes slowly into war, not rush headlong into war. And that's my problem with Tomahawk missiles and MOABs, the smart bombs. Tomahawk missiles, smart bombs, mother of all bombs, have great appeal to men who think you can solve a problem just by pressing a button. These missiles are sold to us as clean hits. They're laser guided. There are even little cameras on them so you can watch as they hit their target. And it's all clean, right? Even an unwashed degenerate living in his mother's attic, logging onto Pornhub at 4 in the morning, couldn't dream up this level of fetish porn. Like fetish porn, Tomahawk missiles are a fantasy. Smart bombs are a fantasy. Winning a war from the air is a fantasy. It just is. And it's something that we wish were true, which is why we continue to jerk off to it. It's why firing 60-some-odd Tomahawk missiles into Syria feels so good. Because it's porn. We watch it on CNN, and it temporarily fulfills the fantasy that we can solve the world's problems with just the push of a button. Tomahawk missiles, you fired. And it's over. But it's not. It's not over. All we did was feel good temporarily. There's a problem in Syria, and we have to do something, right? Well, let's just fire some bombs, because that's the easiest thing to do. Bringing Syrian refugees into America? No, we can't do that. Each Tomahawk missile is a couple of million dollars. How much food and medicine could that money deliver to Syrian refugees instead of bombing their country? But there's nothing telegenic about America handing money to the United Nations And then UN peacekeepers showing up in a refugee camp and slowly, methodically inoculating and then feeding Syrian refugees. There's nothing to watch but a show of force. Well, that's a show. Shock and awe is something we love seeing that on TV. It's July 4th. The rocket's red glare, bombs bursting in air, and no people. We don't see people. We don't see people, no people. We can't even see the refugees being fed or being given medicine, because that's disturbing. No, the only Syrian children we see are the ones who were killed by sarin gas, because they're dead, and dead children can't be brought to America. So they're no threat to us. CNN shows us the dead children in Syria because that can motivate us to get even, you know, to go to war, to fire missiles at the culprit behind the dead children. Dead Syrian children, dead from sarin gas, that's an eye for an eye. But, you know, starving Syrian children who need a safe place to live, well, that's far more disturbing to the American people, because that means we have to actually do something other than press a button and fire a missile. That's our fetish porn, these Tomahawk missiles. They can solve every problem. Press a button, fire those missiles, and of course, Assad will stop gassing his own people. He'll wise up, and the war will end because America has spoken and the world listens. It's just a fantasy. And someone like Trump wants to believe that. And he will cherry pick each fact to back up the belief that Tomahawks can solve your problems, because that's what incurious people have to do. And advisors will tell them anything, just as long as it's not their life or career on the line. For $1,000 an hour, a lawyer will tell Donald Trump there's no such thing as marital rape. Military advisors will tell the president that America can win a war from the air, because it's what everyone likes to think, and it's safe to recommend an air assault. Safe to recommend an air assault, because no American soldiers get killed. Just innocent women and children. The fact is, air assaults don't work. We dropped, and please pay attention to this, we dropped more bombs on North Vietnam than all the bombs we dropped on Germany, Japan, Korea combined. Listen to me. During the Vietnam War, America dropped more bombs on Vietnam than all the bombs we had ever dropped in all our wars combined. And last time I checked, North Vietnam no longer exists. It's Vietnam. The whole country is communist. Remember shock and awe? Remember when George W. Bush invaded Iraq? First, he softened up the Republican Guard. Not his Republican Guard, the other band of Republican murderers, Hussein's Republican Guard. He softened them up with shock and awe. Daisy cutters. They were like Moab, the mother of all bombs. And we dropped a daisy cutter into Baghdad. And for a while, we thought we got Saddam Hussein. Of course, we didn't. Took almost a year to find him. But that shock and awe looked pretty great. Smoke, flame, sirens. But we weren't allowed to see dead people. Most of you are too young to remember this, but when we invaded Iraq in 2003, it was considered bad cricket if the television networks showed any dead Iraqis. No, you had to turn on Al Jazeera to see the dead Arabs in Iraq. And they were killed by our smart bombs. Rumsfeld and Bush, they kept telling us smart bombs were precise and there would be no collateral damage. But Al Jazeera told us otherwise. They showed pictures, and we didn't get to see them unless we watched Al Jazeera. Al Jazeera was showing us the hospitals and the kids being treated or dying from our smart bombs. So we bombed Al Jazeera. On the morning of April 8th, 2003, at 7:40 a.m., Al Jazeera's Baghdad office was attacked by a Warthog ground attack aircraft, and it killed several journalists. But, of course, it was an accident, because America doesn't kill journalists, and we don't kill children, and we certainly don't kill innocent people, because we're America. Our bombs are smart, just like are presidents who lead us into war. According to the Iraq Body Count Project, which counts the number of dead civilians following the 2003 invasion of Iraq, instigated by George W. Bush, 70% of the casualties in that invasion were civilians. Not enemy combatants, not militia, not the military. 70% were innocent civilians. And so Donald Trump bombs Syria. He bombs Afghanistan. We're being told he's presidential now. His poll numbers are getting, as they say, yeasty. They're rising because he's killing people. America kills innocent women and children overseas. They tend to be Arab. Do I want to believe that America doesn't kill innocent women and children overseas? Yes, but it's simply not true. So I don't waste my time fantasizing about shock and awe, about winning wars from the air. I don't fantasize that there are smart bombs that can pull off a pinprick attack without killing anybody but the intended target. I deal with reality when it comes to war. I don't fantasize that America doesn't kill journalists. That's not my fantasy. My fantasy is I get hired to write on a television show. It's 1981. I want to get physical. Olivia Newton-John is the guest. I write a sketch for her to perform in. I come into her dressing room, and she's just finished one of her I want to get physical workouts. She's wearing a headband, tight spandex workout pants, and she apologizes because she hasn't showered. I smile and say, "We're working. You don't need to shower." Olivia Newton-John reads my sketch, and she laughs hysterically. She punches my arm teasingly and calls me a bad boy because of my jokes. Then she says, "Will you excuse me? I need to take a shower." I say, "Sure, I'll just sit and reread the sketch and see if I can't make a few more changes." She sings in the shower. She's singing "Please, Mr. Please," and the door to her bathroom is slightly ajar, and steam is drifting out, and suddenly I hear, "Oh, David." "Yes, Ms. Newton-John, or is it Ms. John?" And she laughs, and she says, "Can you be a love and help me for a second?" And I say, "Ms. John, do you want me in the John?" And there's a long pause, and she realizes I try to make a joke, and she says, "I hope these horrible puns aren't going to end up in my script, you bad, bad boy." I walk into the bathroom. Olivia's still in the shower, and it's like I'm back in high school, rock hard. And Olivia Newton-John pokes her head behind the glass shower door and says, "I like smart, funny men whose hair transplants just need a little more work." I smile. Then Olivia Newton-John says she's starting a world tour and needs someone to travel with her and write zingy one-liners. It would be a grueling 60-day tour, but we'd stay in the finest hotels, like the Four Seasons, and I would have to come to every one of her shows and listen to her sing, and she would be singing directly to me because in order to write my zingy one-liners for Olivia Newton-John, I need to understand exactly where her instrument is emotionally. We would be with each other 24 hours a day, and since this is all last minute, the five-star hotels have all been booked, so I would have to stay in her suite, just the two of us. She likes to sing when she's in the hotel, especially when she's making love, which, you know, she needs to do all the time because her voice coach says it really loosens up the pipes. I say, "Well, yes, I could do that." So the next day I pack and head to the airport to get on Olivia Newton-John's private jet. As I'm heading to the airport, the cab driver, it's 1981, reeks of cheap Aramis knockoff, and I ask him to crack the window, and he does, but I still can't shake the stench of his body odor, cigarette breath, and cheap Aramis knockoff. Then suddenly one of Olivia's songs come on the radio. It's Please, Mr. Please. And I start thinking, why the hell should I have to put up with this crap from this lousy cab driver? I'm David Feldman. I'm about to get on a private jet with Olivia Newton-John. And for the next 60 days, it's going to be first-class accommodations. I'm going to be sharing a bed with Olivia Newton-John. And I have to put up with this crap? So I flick the back of the cab driver's head. And I say, hey, pal, have you ever heard of a thing called water? And he goes, oh, there's a bottle of water in the side pocket of the door on the right, if you want any. And no, I don't mean that. I mean water to bathe in. Have you ever heard of that? You smell like meatloaf's shit was reincarnated and came back as a Turkish prison with acid reflux. The driver says something about my hair transplants, and I say, pull over, and he pulls over, and we start going at it. I land a punch. He goes down, but he whips out a shiv. I kick the shiv out of his hand. We roll around on the side of the highway. I notice the shiv is in the middle of La Cienega, and the driver, he rolls over to fetch it, gets run over by a truck, dead instantly. I get into his car and drive off, and this is before cell phones. It's 1981, 1982, but for some reason I have a cell phone, and I text Olivia furiously, and I beg her to hold up the private jet. I tell her I ran into some traffic, and she says, relax, doll. I can't wait to see you. I send her a smile emoji. The police are behind me. The cop tells me I'm texting and driving, and I say, really? This is 1982. What the hell are you pulling me over for texting and driving in 1982? Once you grow a pair of balls, pig, and pull over somebody who's committing a real crime, like designing those shoes you're wearing. Cut to prison. I'm doing 9 to 10 on manslaughter. I'm sharing a cell with a guy named Roy, who's high up in the Brotherhood of Aryan Nations. Turns out Roy's sister is into Jewish comedy writers. Roy and I make a deal. Roy's sister will show up the first Tuesday of every month and press her breasts against the window while I touch myself if I agree to let Roy and the rest of the members of the Brotherhood of Aryan Nations work out their frustrations by battering my butt cheeks like they were the gate of a medieval castle. 9 years later, I'm out of prison. My face is covered in an elaborate tattoo so that when the wind blows my hair plugs straight up and I smile, it looks like a baby grand piano. Olivia is waiting for me outside the prison in a 1948 Ford Deluxe convertible. You know, the one from Greece. She says, it's time to come home. The car suddenly lifts into the sky. I look down and I see my third wife carrying a bag of groceries. And I scream, look at me, Dory. I'm with Olivia Newton-John in the car from Greece. And we're about to sing We'll Always Be Together to each other. You covetous, materialistic golem. That's my fantasy. Because unlike Donald Trump, my penis works. Joining us from Nyack, New York. He's not from Nyack, New York. He's in Nyack, New York, which is one of the most beautiful spots in the world. He is headlining Levity Live in Nyack, New York, this Friday and tomorrow, Saturday. Alonzo Bodden. Hello there, Alonzo.
What's up, David? And, you know, you're right about Nyack. It's funny. I grew up in Queens. I'd never been up here. And it was like, oh, so this is what happens. You cross the George Washington Bridge, and there's a sign that says Palisades, and it's beautiful over here.
Mm-hmm.
Little two-lane highways and the whole, yeah. So this, yeah, it's nice. It's going to be a great weekend.
It's going to be a great weekend. It's beautiful this time of year. I would assume the leaves are just popping.
Just starting to bud. So it's not green yet, but green is coming. I'll tell you what's unusual right now, David. L.A. is green. California is green. The last few years, we've been pretty brown, but we had record-setting rain over the winter. It's really funny. It's like all the hills are green. Well, you know, that's what's unusual. So, yeah, so we're greener than the East Coast for now.
I don't want to violate your privacy, but as I remember, is it fair to say you live near Calabasas?
Not too far. I'm in Studio City, so I'm
okay.
10 miles from Calabasas.
Was there a time that you lived out there? Because I remember you used to take the motorcycle in for
auditions. I ride up there. I ride up through Calabasas and Malibu Canyon and all of that. Yeah, I love riding my motorcycle up there. It's beautiful.
You grew up in Queens. I grew up in Englewood, New Jersey. And I left early on, moved to California. And I knew that there was a life in New York that was exceptional, even better than in L.A., but there was nothing I had to offer the New York metropolitan area to allow me to stay here. And now that I'm back,
interesting way to put it.
Yeah, I just couldn't make a living. I couldn't make a living in New York. Do you feel like, maybe I should move back to New York because this would be a better lifestyle than California?
It never crosses my mind. Every time I visit New York, you know, my family's still here. I'm like, I love visiting New York, but no, I'm a West Coast guy. I love the West. I love the space. I love the weather. Like you said, I'm a motorcycle guy. Motorcycle and car culture is big out there. But it's just something about the lifestyle. I like the L.A. lifestyle versus New York lifestyle. No, nothing wrong with New York. It's just not me. I'm glad I grew up here. I think the education of growing up in New York is like nowhere else, but I love living in L.A.
Where'd you start doing stand-up?
L.A. L.A. is where I started.
Now,
in 93.
You started in 93. You used to make airplanes, model airplanes, and then you destroyed your brain from the glue, right? That's what I read.
That's like a Wikipedia version of my story. Where you ever look on Wikipedia and find out things about yourself you didn't know? Like, hey, I didn't know that. Okay, so I built model airplanes and I sniffed airplane glue. Yeah, why not?
I found out I host a podcast. You made airplanes, right?
I did. I worked on real airplanes, and it's funny because I learned to do that in New York. I went to aviation high school in Long Island City. And I was hired by Lockheed Aircraft in Burbank. So I moved to L.A. And, I mean, I literally got there and just never looked back. And, for the first, let's see, for 13 years, I spent 10 years building and fixing airplanes and then 3 years training people and having fun making them laugh before I crossed over. And, you know, back when we built them, we never thought to make the aisle wider so that when you beat a passenger and drag him off the plane, there would be more room, like you could comfortably drag him versus having to twist the body to the side to drag it. See, the engineers just don't think of these things. How horrible was that?
What do you mean you built airplanes? Because I know we've talked about this before.
I literally built, you know, the main airplane I worked on was the original stealth fighter for your listeners. If they want to Google it, just Google F-117.
You built a stealth bomber?
No, not the bomber, the fighter. The fighter was used in the first Gulf War. No, it was an attack plane, but it wasn't considered a bomber because it only could carry two missiles at a time. Or I think they could put four smaller ones, two big ones or four smaller ones. But the big thing about it, it was the first airplane that radar couldn't see. It could fly through a radar area. And well, you're old enough to remember. Remember a movie called Firefox with Clint Eastwood?
I'm going to pretend that I'm not old enough. Who's Clint Eastwood?
Okay, let me refresh. There was a movie. It came out in the early 80s, and the plot line was that Russia had invented this top-secret airplane that you couldn't see it on radar, and it was silent, and it would project false images of itself, and it had no heat trace, and it was basically an invisible airplane. And the idea was for Clint Eastwood to steal this airplane from the Russians so that the Americans could make the technology, blah, 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 right? Well, when that movie came out, we were actually building a plane that could do all of that, and it was top secret. And oh, we're like, can we tell anyone? Can we tell anyone that we actually know that? Like, we make one of those?
Wow. You know?
And the cool thing, the full circle experience, was around 98, 99, I was doing a show in Kuwait, and I was at the base where they kept these planes because they used them, like I said, in the first Iraq-Kuwait war. And when we got there and they're showing us the plane and I start talking about it and they're like, hey, wait a minute, how do you know all of this? And I was like, well, kind of knew it before you did, young man.
So you came to work to make a stealth bomber or a stealth fighter. Could you find it every day? I mean, was it easy to spot? That's a horrible...
No, it's an easy joke. It's an easy joke. It's right there. Yes, we did find it. I will tell you, this is how secret that job was. Okay, you're too young to remember this,
but your
older listeners will remember. Big scandal about the $600 toilet seats and the $1,000 hammers.
Yeah.
And all of that.
Well, I remember that.
What that was, that's how they, and I learned this later, that's how they finance secret projects, right? So you have this, we were in like an assembly line in a building.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's all sealed up. Like once we went to work, like you went into work and they closed the door and you couldn't leave until the end of the day. It wasn't like you could go in or out or anything like that. So what they did was they had an assembly line of a plane that the government knows about, that people know about, and you do a bunch of overcharges on that one to pay for the secret one that people don't know about. And that's how they finance these projects. Well, that's how they used to finance these projects. Who knows what's going on now? But yeah.
Wow.
So when they talked about a $600 toilet seat, it was like, well, actually it's an $8 toilet seat and $592 is going to finance the secret military project.
You know, I just remembered a joke from my act. I apologize for bringing this up, but Reagan was president, and I remember there was like a $700 coffee maker. Mm. And this was like, I just started doing comedy, and I said, for $700, I want that coffee maker to brew it and blow me. And it worked at the time because I was starting. But they can't audit the Pentagon, and I guess that's why, right?
And that's how they do it. And you know who, when that plane, when it was declassified, the person who gave up the secret was a congressman. Some congressman wanted to prove, like, this is what we, this is what we do, this is what we authorize. And he was like, look at this badass plane we've been building. And everybody was like, you weren't supposed to mention that,
So you had top secret clearance. What's that like? Do they investigate
you? For me, it was actually very easy because they check back to when you're 18, and I started at Lockheed when I was like 18 and 3 weeks. So the funniest thing about that was I moved to California, and then 2 weeks later, I got friends in New York calling me like, hey, man, what'd you do out there? The FBI was asking about you.
So they
do the background check and the FBI, I mean, again, I'm a kid just out of high school, so there wasn't much to investigate. Right. There wasn't much trouble I could have gotten into at that point. But, yeah, they did the background check and the whole thing, and I had the secret and then the top secret clearance.
By the time you were 18, you were making airplanes.
Yeah. It's an amazing, when I look back on it, I mean, it's what I did. And I had a bunch of friends from high school and we all did it. We just had sort of a reunion out in L.A. of the guys who stayed in California and who are making. But yeah, when you look back on it, it was ridiculous. Like, we had just learned to build planes in high school, and now we're building the most advanced, top secret plane, you know, in the world at the time. And to us, it was like, okay, just another airplane, you know. Just
what year again was this?
This was 80 to 84. I worked there.
80 to 84. Okay. And then I see. How does your mind work?
In that sense, in the mechanical sense, I have a great appreciation of mechanical things. And I can just kind of see how things go together and how things are supposed to work. That would probably explain why I never got married, because I'd look at a woman and be like, this thing just doesn't, it doesn't work right. It doesn't, no, what the hell?
It's like marriage is like the bumblebee. If you show a bumblebee to people like you who know how things fly, they cannot explain how a bumblebee flies.
Well, there are two theories of flight, okay? There's what's known as the Bernoulli principle. And the Bernoulli principle is that as air moves faster, pressure drops, which creates lift. And that's the theory that the air rushing over the wing creates a low pressure area above the wing, which lifts the plane. But the other theory is if you put power behind it, it'll fly. That's the theory that says if you throw a brick, it will fly. So those are the two theories that come together. So, yeah. But, yeah, the bumblebee thing was a poster in the hangar where we were building, because that plane was also the first one that it couldn't fly without the computers. The computers had to, you know, account for the aerodynamics of the airplane. So it literally was like a bumblebee, and like that, without the computers, this thing can't fly. But getting back to women, no, they're beyond bumblebees.
Yeah, marriage is like the bumblebee.
Yeah.
You just have to believe in the honey. Did they ever figure out why a bumblebee flies?
I think it has to do with the speed of the wings, if I remember correctly. But mathematically, it shouldn't work, but it does. But I think it had to do with the speed that they can vibrate their wings.
Is that how a helicopter flies?
No. You know what a helicopter is? What you think is the propeller on top of a helicopter is actually a wing. It's a wing that rotates. So it's built like the airplane wings. If you could imagine airplane wings spinning fast enough to create lift, that's how a helicopter flies.
You flew today, correct?
Yeah.
What airline?
United.
Seriously.
And I survived. And seriously. You know, I talked about this on my podcast. See, I'm one of these people that's very torn, because I'm a platinum level flyer with 1,000,000 miles on United. So when you say that, you know, I'm going to walk away and I'll never fly this airline again, I'm kind of vested in flying on this airline. And the other thing, and you know this, David, you traveled too, they all suck.
Right.
You know, it's like it's United's turn in the barrel. United didn't do anything that Delta or American wouldn't have done in the same position.
Right.
They just happen to do it. Like, they all suck. There's no airline that doesn't treat you like shit.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm obviously not happy with them. The CEO did say that they promised they will no longer physically drag passengers off the plane. So we got that going for us, you know. So
what?
Far, Delta and American haven't made that promise. They still have one free drag to get away with.
Well, there'd be no flight. Bernoulli's principle is all about drag, isn't it? What is it like to have 1,000,000 miles?
You know, it's cool. This is the benefit they give you for having 1,000,000 miles. I'll be a gold level flyer for life. So in other words, if I stop flying so much, I maintain gold level. Now, the problem with that is that was great when there were numerous airlines. As they merge, what they don't tell you is, like, when United merges with Continental, now you've got, you know, the 10,000 gold members of Continental and the 10,000 gold members. So your chance of getting an upgrade or any benefit was just cut in half.
Mm-hmm.
because twice as many people are in it. But it's good. I'll tell you what I don't know, because let me tell you something. They don't treat me that special, and I'm platinum with a million miles. So I don't know how they're treating you in group four. I think in group four they might just beat you with a stick and tie you in a chair. I don't know. You know, it's like, look, I'm platinum, and they ain't too happy with me. So I don't know what they're doing with you.
How tall are you?
6'3".
How do you sit and coach? And why isn't there a class action suit?
One of the benefits is I get the, I forget what they call it, but the coach seats with the extra leg room. So I sit in that section of the plane where you get a coach seat, but you have business class leg room. So,
but if you can't afford, let's say you're just a normal person without a million miles, don't you have a lawsuit again? I mean,
No. You just suffer. And as a matter of fact, that's being tall. If you're overweight, right? If you're over a certain weight, you have to buy two seats. Seriously, I'm not making that up. I don't know what the weight is, but there's like over a certain size, you know, you got to buy two seats.
Wow.
So you talk about having some money, you know, then it becomes, well, for the price of two seats, you could just buy one seat in business, you know?
Right.
So, yeah, it's uncomfortable at times. And for, if you are, it's not even a matter of being 6'3". I think if you're 6 feet tall, and you're in the regular airplane seat, you're going to be cramped, right? Because they've shortened the pitch, like they've shortened the legroom to fit that extra row of seats in and sell those extra seats. And this is why you have this air rage where people are like, you recline your seat that 2 inches and you bang the knee at a person behind you, then they hit the seat and blah, blah, blah. And there definitely been cases of you know, people getting into fights or coming close to fighting over that 2-inch recline of the seat. And that's where the flight attendants, they catch hell, right? Because some guy in an office, you know, makes this policy, and then some engineer designs it. Oh, well, we can make the seat this much smaller, blah, blah, blah. But then when two people are on a red eye, tired and pissed off, it's the flight attendant who has to try to get between them when they're about to kill each other.
What's the best flight you ever had?
Virgin Atlantic business class. There's two flights I did that were incredible. I did the Virgin business class from London to L.A. And they literally, like, you have to tell the flight attendant, leave me alone. Like, they're just, would you like a blanket? What would you like to eat? They'll cook you in the lounge before you get on the plane. They, like, have a chef in the lounge. Anything you'd like, we'll make for you, blah, 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 blah. That one was incredible.
And back and rubs, right? Don't they give back rubs?
They have massages, and they also have a barber. They have the whole thing. I'm not kidding. I'm not exaggerating or making this up. No, they have massages, a barber. You know, you can get a pedicure while you're waiting for in the lounge and all of that. That's all. A spa. Basically, they have a spa in the lounge. And then the other one I flew that was incredible was Singapore Air. I was doing this gig in Indonesia, and they flew me business class on Singapore. And that's the one where your seat folds down into a bed, and they put a curtain around you, so you have your like own little private room to fly in. You know, that and they have, I think they have like one flight attendant for every four people or something like that. Some crazy, you know, ratio of, yeah, we're here to take care of, you know. Those are the flights that are amazing.
You don't want them to end.
No, then you're comfortable. You're like, yeah, if I flew like this. But then you see the cost of the ticket. And, like, when we did the Virgin America thing, that was part of a military gig, part of a USO thing. So they donate the seats, you know, as a donation to the USO. But we saw the price of the tickets, and the tickets cost more than we were getting paid to do the gig.
Wow. Yeah. Do you think, because I, you know, I always think about how the environment affects my mood. I often think, you know, if I didn't live in America, I'd be a lot happier. If I, you know, when I go to Canada or Italy, I'm happy. When I come back to America, I'm tense. I'm afraid I'm going to get shot. When I'm on a train, it is impossible impossible for me to be anxious or depressed. I think I could, I mean, I think heaven to me would be first class accommodations on a train, just a permanent train ride. I also think the few times that I've flown first class, I think I could just sit on a plane forever and just keep flying around the world. There was a time when you could buy, the rich people were doing this in the 70s and the 80s. I think it was like $250,000. You could buy a lifetime first class seat on American Airlines, which means you could pretty much just live in the air.
Yeah, I don't know if they still do that. I know they do have some of these, like, around-the-world tickets. Like, you can get on and off planes and go around the world over a period of time. Maybe it's a year or something like that. I will tell you this, that if I'm going across the country, business class is worth it. You know, like, if you're flying a two-hour flight or whatever, it's not that big a difference. It's nice, and depending on the price, I may or may not do it. But if I'm going, like this trip, coming from L.A. here, I would rather, I did a flight where I had to stop and change planes, but I'd rather do that and get business class than go direct in coach.
Yeah, I'm all about the suffering. I always think, you know, what's my, you know, if I could save $300, 6 hours, that's, what is that, $50 an hour? That's how I figure. I'm making $50 an hour by not paying extra for, you know.
You know, it's funny. My business manager was the opposite, because I used to do that. And she was like, look, your travel is business. Just spend the money. She was like, if you, you know, you got it, like, so you'll make an extra, you know, you'll make, you know, a few $100 less, but you'll be comfortable on a five-hour flight. Just spend the money. So then I started doing it. And, you accumulate perks faster. You accumulate miles and all of that stuff faster. So there are advantages to doing it. But flying, it's the work. You know, when people ask what I do, I like, look, they pay me to travel. I tell jokes for free.
Wow.
That's the gig.
Wow.
Because the travel, and if you talk to anybody who travels on business on a more or less weekly basis, you know, I'm probably in an airport 40 weeks out of the year. And, yeah, it's a job.
Are you on the road that much? John Fugel's saying, and I thought I was going to see you on Fugel Sang's Sirius XM show today, but you were on it 2 and I was on it 4. And people were calling in to ask to speak to you, and he's been gone for 2 hours.
I love John's show. Yeah. As you know, John's show is intelligent, and he lets you be you, and it's just phenomenal.
But you told him that you're on the road most of the time. Is that true?
Yeah.
40 weeks,
you know,
out,
David,
of the year?
I'm a comic, you know, and I was telling him, in the past few years, I've really, like, I've always been a comic, but it's been more like embracing it, like, yeah, this is what I do. So, you know, I love when I get a TV spot, you get the occasional acting job or voiceover job, but this is what I do, man. I'm a comic. So I'm not in clubs all the time. I do some clubs. It's a combination. I do clubs. I do corporate. My favorite thing that I get to work with are a lot of jazz artists. I open for some jazz artists. I host some jazz festivals. And I love that because I love the music. And I love that synergy between music and comedy, you know, on a creative level. But, yeah, this is what I do. So, you know, I got to travel. It's part of the job. So when I say I'm in the airport 40 weeks a year, sometimes it's just for one night. Like, I was telling a friend, I don't even consider that travel. If I fly out Thursday, work Thursday night and come home Friday, as far as I'm concerned, that didn't even count. you know. But
so
the club
jazz,
weeks are 3 or 4 days.
There are two American art forms that I believe are purely American, and that would be jazz and stand-up comedy. Is that a fair
statement?
Yeah,
I'd say that's pretty accurate. I'd say that is a pretty accurate statement.
When I was starting out, they used to play rock and roll in the clubs, and I remembered Mort Saul, who started in San Francisco, opening for jazz musicians, Dave Brubeck, and I would say, shouldn't you be playing jazz? Because jazz is what gets the audience in the mood to think. And, you know, with jazz, you get a premise and then variations on the theme. And then you come back to the premise and then you go away and come back. And the musicians will test how far away they can go from the theme and then bring you back. That's what stand-up is. And they would say to me, no, we got to rev up the crowd. Comedy's the new rock and roll. I maintain that had they kept the jazz roots, I never would have had to do a joke about a coffee machine blowing me.
Well, that is the beauty of it. And, you know, you talk about San Francisco, and that was a place where it took place on that level. Yeah, on the creative level, they are the same thing. And what you said is exactly true. Like, it would be great if you have an audience. If you have an audience that gets jazz, they're going to love comedy, you know, creative comedy. I mean, one of the best compliments I got was when I'm just doing crowd work, right? And to comics, it's just fun doing crowd work. And sometimes I test myself, like, how can I tie these things in or doing whatever. And there were a bunch of musicians at the show, and they were like, man, that's jazz. That's just straight improvisation. We love that, you know. And coming from guys whose whole musical world is improvisation, that's a high compliment. But you're right. If you know, I get the rock and roll aspect of it. I've always understood that aspect of comedy. I've always understood the money-making aspect of comedy, you know, put asses in seats, sell drinks, blah, blah, blah. But when you get those rooms, and you know what I'm talking about, where it's just creativity, and the audience appreciates the creativity of comedy. There used to be a room on Vancouver Island, and it was a jazz club during the week and comedy on Friday and Saturday.
Did John Fox book that?
I did it with Pat Wilson. Pat Wilson was booking it when I did it. But you could feel it, like, in the room. Like, it had that smoky velvet room feel, like you'd never have to raise your voice, you know, that kind of room. And I loved it. It was just so creative, and that's a beautiful thing. Yeah, it's great when those two come together, and a jazz audience is a great comedy audience, you know, because you have people who want to go past loud noises, people who appreciate nuance and so on. And again, I definitely get the rock and roll aspect of comedy, and you know, any of us would want to be a rock star, right? It's nice to make a few million dollars a year. Let's not kid ourselves, you know. I know a few millionaires, and it looks like a nice life. But from a creative standpoint, if I can, I'm making a good living, and I can do the creative stuff and do the stuff that I love, then that's cool too.
Who are some of the best jazz musicians around these days?
A friend of mine, I'm biased, but I think he's brilliant. A guy named Marcus Miller.
What does he play?
He plays the bass. But that's putting it mildly. But just to give you an idea, this guy, at 19, Miles Davis put him in his band.
Wow.
Okay, now think about what you were doing at 19. I think about what I was doing at 19. There was no danger of Miles Davis hiring me.
Unless he needed a stealth fighter.
But, yeah, Marcus played with Miles, and then he was Luther Vandross music director for all of those hits through the 80s. So he did the R&B thing, but he has his own jazz vibe. I'm a big fan and friend of his. There's a guy named Robert Glasper. A brilliant pianist who has two different bands. He has a jazz trio, and then he has a R&B band called the Robert Glasper Experiment, and he's won Grammys on both sides, you know. So that's kind of brilliant. And, you know, then the masters like Herbie Hancock and, you know, Miles, people like that, Chick Corea, I've always loved them. But, yeah, there are some young guys. There's a guy named Christian Scott, who's an incredible trumpet player that I listen to. There are some younger guys, guys in their 30s and 40s, who are making some incredible jazz. And it's very cool because they're using all influences now. Like, the hip-hop has become an influence in jazz and vice versa. and that's really cool what some people are doing with that. So,
do you listen to jazz at home, and when do you listen to it?
Yeah, I listen to it probably more than anything else. I listen to jazz at home. I listen to it in the car. And, yeah, that's my music. That's my soundtrack.
L.A. K-Jazz.
Yeah. The problem with radio, radio doesn't give jazz enough airplay. Yeah. You know, meaning that, like, when you listen to a K-Jazz, they do a lot of the old traditional jazz, what they call straight-ahead jazz, but you won't hear a lot of the fusion or the newer, the more contemporary stuff being done.
I've been told I don't know anything about this stuff, but purists look down on that stuff, right?
Yeah, they do. And then they don't, you know, it's, and this is what I mean. Like a guy like Robert Glasper, right, who has this electronic R&B band and does covers of like Smells Like Teen Spirit. You know, people are like, oh, well, what does he know? Blah, blah, blah. And then he does a duet with Herbie Hancock, where him and Herbie are both on, you know, traditional acoustic pianos. And you're like, oh, yeah, so tell Herbie that this kid doesn't know anything about jazz, because what the hell does Herbie know? You know what I mean?
Right.
So yeah, that's what proves the snobs wrong. When these guys who, you know, like I say, like Marcus plays an electric bass. Right. So you do. Oh, well, you know, if you're not playing that, a big acoustic bass or this or that. And it's like, yeah, he wrote the song Tutu for Miles Davis. So, you know, so he's got that going for him. You know what
right.
I mean? So, yeah. So the jazz snobs, sorry. But, you know, and the thing about that is jazz was always about improvisation and change. Right. I mean, back in the 50s when they were first starting rock and roll, those musicians learned how to play from jazz musicians, you know, and that's what they talk about. Like, that's who they used to listen to, right? Jazz and blues musicians, and they transitioned and made it into rock and roll. So there's always going to be a fight for that traditional thing. And the traditional thing is cool, but the music is about creativity and about pushing it to the next, whatever the next level is going to be. I mean, in hip hop, you look at, you know, it's funny. You got a guy like a Bob James, who's a jazz pianist. Ask Bob if he loves hip hop. He loves hip hop because rappers have been sampling his jazz and his funk, and he's made, you know, probably a couple $1 million on the side from, you know, from rappers sampling his music. He's like, oh, yeah, big fan of hip-hop. Love the hip-hop.
Are you a fan of comedy?
Yes.
Can you watch, can you enjoy stand-up?
Yeah, I like watching people who do things different than I do. And then I just like watching just great stand-ups. Have you seen Chappelle's new stuff on Netflix?
Not yet. I'm backed up.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, to watch Dave Chappelle do an hour is like, oh, that's how this is supposed to be done.
How do you watch stand-up? I was talking to this professor, Corey Brettschneider, who's a regular on this show. He's a constitutional law professor, and he was teaching me how to read a Supreme Court decision. And we've talked about how do you watch Shakespeare? And I always say, well, you got to know the story first so you can appreciate the language and the acting. If you're trying to ferret out the plot, you're going to be lost. How do you approach stand-up when you watch it?
I think it depends on who's doing it. If I'm watching Chappelle, it's almost like I'm a student. You know, I'm wide, like, wow, look what he can do. Look how he did this. Look where he went with that, you know. And then he's got, I don't want to ruin it for you because you haven't seen it, but if you see the special, he does a couple of things where, and you know, the highest compliment we comics can give is like, man, I wish I thought of that, you know. And he came up with this thread that he ran through one of the specials that was like, oh, my God, that is so funny, to where by the third time he did it, like all he said was the premise, mm-hmm. and the crowd just lost it because it's such a, it was an unusual yet brilliant thread to run through a comedy special. you know, then sometimes I watch people like Ollie Long. She just makes me laugh. You know, I like some of the young comics. Some of them are, I don't know how to describe it. There's some of it that I think is fake, and I think it's like the emperor has no clothes. You know what I mean? Like people are acting like this is hip and different, but just for the sake of saying it's hip and different. Mm-hmm. And then some of them I think are really onto something that is really funny and unique. Jared Carmichael is another mm-hmm. one. I can watch Jared. I watch him for his premises, because he comes up with ideas, and the way he states the premise is funny, and it makes you think before he starts doing the jokes. You know, so I admire that. And then, like I say, the masters, you know, to watch Lewis Black mm-hmm. do an hour. Like, I can't watch Lou too much because I'll start doing Lou.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it just, I love it so much, and it's like, I don't know how to explain it. So sometimes I watch as a fan, and sometimes I watch as a student.
Let me get back to Chappelle and the freedom on stage. If you're free on stage, and that comes with celebrity or a really kind audience, you can go into areas that you never thought possible. The audience will almost take you there. It's almost like a plane taking off, right? If you have a great audience, is it Bernelli's principle?
I mean, they'll go anywhere with Dave because, you know, he's going to make it funny. You know, Dave is one of the few people that I would pay to watch think out loud.
He thinks out loud, and he would do like 6-hour sets at the Laugh Factory. Can you get there? Are you ever in a city? Are you ever, obviously you are, but I mean, can you just throw out your act and do an hour and just fly?
I do that in the jazz world. I do that in the jazz world because, like, I do these jazz cruises, right? And you know, there's 40 jazz musicians, and I'm the only comic. So the first show I do material. But the second show, okay, you guys have seen my material. It's the same audience. I'm not doing the same hour. And that's where I'll just start playing around. And I'm surprised at how much they'll come along with me for the ride. And I'm just looking for things. And then, sometimes, you know, it's the other times I love doing that is an empty night at the Laugh Factory.
Mm-hmm.
Some of my best sets, because that stage is so home to me. And when it's, you know, 30 people, it's like, all right, look, I'm not going to jump around and shout, and we're not doing the set. Let's talk for a while. Let's see where this goes. And I love doing it there. And Dave does the same thing with, you know, 400 people in a club or 2,000 people in a theater, because they know him and they know what he does. And you know, part of that is just trusting you could do it anyway. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think he's ever been one limited by the desire to make the crowd laugh.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm fascinated by this, because you're really doing it, and you're out on the road 40 weeks, and you're the jazz audiences. Would you say that the audience is kind of like another instrument, so that you're working with them? It's almost, when you're working on new material, you're kind of playing your tune, and then you listen to them, and it's back and forth. It's this great combination.
Yes and no. I think it's more...
Are you there?
I'm sorry. I just had to look at something. Right, something I got to take care of.
Oh,
but
okay.
Anyway, no, I think... I don't know if I'd say they're an instrument as much as it is they will just... They appreciate it. I think that's more. I think it's more their appreciation. So they appreciate you experimenting with stuff, and they're like, oh, yeah, that works. Or, oh, yeah, that's, you know, or maybe there's something funny there, but I haven't found it yet. But yeah. So I don't think I'm not trying to play them. I'm not trying to make them laugh. I'm just, you know what I mean? I'm just.
Are you dancing with them or boxing with them?
I like boxing better than dancing. Yeah, I like throwing jabs. I like throwing jabs, and I like throwing the hook that they don't see coming.
Right.
And knocking them on their ass, you know.
Right.
And they appreciate that. They appreciate the hook that they didn't see coming.
The Marquis de Queensberry, there are rules to boxing. Isn't that the Marquis de Queensberry?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is what I remember about you. We did the gala in Montreal. It was a political show. And you were incredibly clean. And I wasn't. This was like 3 or 4, maybe 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. And your act was immaculate. And I watched it thinking, wow. You have high standards. Do you get pissed off if the person in front of you is doing jokes about their coffee maker blowing them?
Not really. I think, you know what bothers me more? When someone takes a premise and does nothing with it, then they destroy the premise. You know, like take a Ben Carson, right? Because lately I just have fun with this idiot. You know, he annoys me, so it's fun making. But then you have somebody say, oh, that Ben Carson. Oh, what an idiot. Stupid Ben Carson said that, you know, slaves were immigrants. Ah! And then they don't. And now it's like, okay, so now the premise has been trashed with no punchline or no joke or, you know, yeah, Trump's an idiot. Well, why? Like, give me a reason. Say something. Go beyond stating the obvious. Even though the obvious can get a laugh, take it to it. You know what I mean? Take it to, or don't touch it. It's like if your whole act is, you know, jokes about, you know, sex jokes or jokes about whatever. You know, and then you go into politics, but you don't do politics. So now you're just stating a bunch of premises or words that you've heard before and trashing them. I would rather you do coffee maker blowjob jokes.
Right.
You know, there's not to say that no one should ever do politics or whatever, you know, do whatever you want. But yeah, that bothers me more. I don't, if you work dirty, then work dirty. But Don't ruin a good premise with no joke.
Yeah.
That annoys me.
Well, I know you've had a long day and you've got an even longer one tomorrow. I just want to ask you about the Texas military bases and your podcast, Who's Paying Attention? And I also just want to know if you had any thoughts on Don Rickles.
Oh, three great topics. I'll start with Don Rickles. And, you know, you mentioned the galas in Montreal. 2 years ago, I did a gala hosted by Don Rickles, and truly one of the great moments in my comedic life, if not in my life period, was getting roasted backstage by Don Rickles. You know, it's on my Facebook page. If you go to Facebook / Alonzo Bodden, it's on there. And Rickles just rips into me, starting with, name's Alonzo. Oh, that's good. You took a white man's name, so the cops won't think you did it. You know, and just goes from there. And you know, David, I mean, is there a more legendary moment in comedy than Don Rickles just ripping on you, you know, with Rickles humor? I loved it. That was great. You know, he's one of those old masters. I mean, we're losing those guys. These guys had one-liners, and they were quick. You know, I was reading, like, there were just all kind of things about Rickles online and everywhere else, and they were talking about, I don't know where he was, but Barack Obama was there. It was some presidential. Oh, yeah, Obama. He was at my house last week. Yeah, you forgot the mop. You know, and who said that to Barack Obama? Yeah, and Obama just falls out laughing because it was Don Rickles. Like, nobody else can say to him, you forgot the mop. But Rickles, bam. Yeah.
I remember people saying he crossed the line on that joke.
I don't think he did. And I don't think Barack Obama thought he did.
Okay.
Because the thing about Don Rickles, Don Rickles said things that, especially today, you know, that might have been funny in 72 that were horrible today.
Mm-hmm.
But it's Don Rickles saying it. If there's one thing about Don Rickles that you knew, there was never any hatred behind his jokes.
Right.
You just knew there was never. Now, there are some other insult comedians that, and you could tell when they mean it. You know what I mean? And that's when it's not funny. That's when it's awkward and blah, blah, blah. Rickles, if he hated anyone, he hated everyone equally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I saw him do this thing. He was like making fun of these Hawaiians doing some weird Polynesian noises. And you're like, now, who does? You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Of course it was cheap and racist, but it was hilarious. And the thing about Rickles, you always saw the person he was making fun of laughing about it.
Right.
I never saw the person that he was making fun of not laugh about it. I mean, he made fun of Sinatra and didn't get killed. you know?
And he was free. I mean, I've been watching him on YouTube for years now, and he was free. I mean, he would go on Carson, and I'd think, how does he fly this way without? And he would crash and get right back up and keep a lot like Jonathan Winters. The growing up, were your parents offended by him?
No. My mother has a great sense of humor. I've always said she might be the funniest person I know. My mom always made me laugh. So she would laugh at good humor. If something was funny, she'd laugh at it. And, you know, and again, with Don Rickles, there was something about him. And you can tell, you know, the opposite would be Michael Richards, right? Kramer.
Right.
When Kramer went off at the Laugh Factory, the crowd, so you were talking about the crowd earlier as a musical instrument. I've always seen the crowd as like the crowd senses things. Like, you know how they say a dog can sense something? A dog can sense fear or aggression or whatever. I've always felt the crowd is the same way. The crowd knows the truth. And if you crack a racist remark or some kind of remark like that, if you mean it, the crowd knows you mean it.
Right.
And that was what happened with Kramer.
So you're saying when a man stands in front of an audience and screams the N-word 100 times, he means it? Well, I have a theory about it.
No, but I mean, then you see like a Don Rickles, right? And when Don Rickles makes a joke about me going to San Quentin, like, you know, it's come on, that shit is funny. You know, that's like he's not Jeff Sessions, who really means he wants to send me to San Quentin. You know, it's you can always tell, and the crowd can tell. Same thing with jokes about women. You know, women know when it's a joke about women, and they know when it's a misogynist hating women, and so on, or vice versa. When a woman makes a joke about a man, you know. And things like that. I've always felt the audience knows the truth. And with Don Rickles, and you know, I could be dead wrong, right? Maybe they'll find some secret, but I just never felt any animosity toward anyone Don Rickles ever made fun of. I just never felt it.
Yeah.
Never saw it. Never saw anything. Never saw him make fun of one group any more than any other group.
Yeah, I think 20 years from now, 50 years from now, he'll be remembered. I think I do. I think he will be like a time capsule that holds up and is fascinating. He is and truly dangerous. Truly. Yeah, I know you got to go, and I apologize because I want to ask.
No, I'm fine.
I remember growing up, my mother watched him on a Dean Martin roast. And he said, oh, Nipsey Russell's here. Let me make you feel at home. All aboard. And my mother said, turn him off.
Yeah.
And then 10 years later, I hear this maniacal laughing coming from her bedroom. And she's watching Don Rickles and just, I think, and that's kind of like the politically correct movement. My mother was being overly protective, but didn't consult the people who she thought she was protecting as to whether or not it was offensive.
Right. Well, another great example of that was Archie Bunker.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Because they always say that All in the Family, like it couldn't be on TV today. Like Archie couldn't say the things that he said. But the thing was, when Archie said it, it was so genuinely ignorant that you didn't hate him for it. That's what made it funny. But now the fat radio guy.
Limbaugh.
Yeah, when Rush Limbaugh.
But the fat radio guy suffices.
Yeah. Yeah. When Limbaugh says the same thing that Archie Bunker said, you know that Rush Limbaugh means it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's a hateful thing. And, you know, so, and again, this is where the audience, you got to give the audience some credit for intelligence and for the ability to discern what's being said. So the audience that watches, the same audience that sees Archie Bunker and sees Rush Limbaugh, they're like, oh, this guy's an actor being funny. This guy is absolutely dangerous. Right. Or this guy is saying exactly what I think. And, you know, let me go put my hood on and let's have a party.
Very quickly, who's paying attention?
I love doing it. It started with my look at the media. I think the most guilty party in what's crumbling now in our society, which is intelligence and truth, it's the media's fault, because it's always been their job to hold the politicians to a standard. You know, when Donald Trump says, you know, a few years ago, Syria's a mistake, we should never bomb Syria, the president can't drop a bomb without Congress, blah, 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 and then he does it, there's no one in the media who holds his feet to the fire, who stands up in the press conference and says, now, wait a minute. Let's not pretend, you know, that. So who's paying attention stems from my frustration with the media and the fact that comedians, we're the only ones left telling the truth. You know, as Lewis Black once said, look, we didn't want this job, but no one else will fucking do it. You know, we'd much rather tell dick jokes.
Right.
But since no one else is going to tell the truth, and, you know, fortunately you have people like Lewis and John Oliver and The Daily Show and stuff like that. And, you know, so yeah, that's where that came from. And
you're going off to Texas to entertain our troops.
I love entertaining the troops. The military, I've been fortunate enough to entertain them overseas and here in the U.S., and it is a mutual admiration. They love the fact that, especially when they're overseas, we bring them a taste of home, you know, and we get to see what they do and actually appreciate what they do. You know, the interesting thing with, like, Iraq, the people who were saying, you know, support the troops. Well, we're going to raise your taxes a dollar to help. No.
Right.
No, we can't raise taxes to help the veterans. You know, so to actually get out there and give them a break from their reality for an hour, and every comic who's done it or who does it, we all love doing it. And then the other thing is, we get to make fun of people they can't make fun of. Like their officers or their sergeants or stuff like that. And it's been my experience, those guys have a great sense of humor about it. Those guys and women, you know. I mean, not disrespecting them, but just making fun of the hierarchy of the military, you know. And, I love entertaining the troops. And it's always been a good experience. And every now and then they let you, you know, play with one of their toys, drive a Humvee or something. They haven't let me blow up anything. I've asked, like, can't we just say it was an accident and blow this fishing boat out of the water? But so far they haven't let me do that.
Mike, too, before you go, and thank you, and we've been talking with Alonzo Bodden. He's at Levity Live in Nyack, New York, Friday, tonight, and Saturday, two shows each night, correct?
Right.
And what time do they start?
7:30 and 9:45.
Please go see him, and go download his podcast on iTunes, Who's Paying Attention? I have two core values when it comes to politics. Medicare for all. That is, you cannot argue with me on Medicare for all. If you don't believe in Medicare for all, there's nothing to talk about. You're another animal as far as I'm concerned. Medicare for all. And the other issue that I'm kind of becoming almost axiomatic about is a draft. I think that we need to have a draft.
And I get that. I get that, because it levels the playing field. That's something they said, that when everybody served in the military, we all cared a lot more about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I understand that. That makes sense.
And I think it makes us better citizens. We pay more attention. We learn to work together. We also learn to respect and loathe authority simultaneously.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and what's even, you know, loathe it, or at the very least question it.
Mm-hmm.
At the very least question it. That's a good thing. I think values-wise, how great would it be if we, you know, since we're always claiming to be a, quote, Christian nation, like, what if we actually did stuff Jesus would do? You know, like help poor people, help sick people, you know, not hate someone because they're different. Like if Jesus came back now, he'd last, what, 15 minutes?
Right? Especially where you're heading, Texas.
The right wing would be like, wait, listen, Jesus. We know you snuck in here with your peace and love and all of that, but we're going to have to shut you down. You know, I mean, wouldn't it be great if we actually adopted, since we claim to and all that, like if we actually adopted those principles, like honestly, I would hate to be a Christian leader if Jesus shows up. You know, if Jesus shows up tomorrow, I'm be like, hey, Jesus, I wasn't with them. I tried to tell them. I know I'm with you. I don't know what they're doing. You know, I don't think Jesus was building a wall or checking. Jesus never asked a leper if he had coverage. Wait, before I lay hands, let me see your insurance. You got coverage? No? All right, put your legs in the basket and get the hell out of here. Jesus didn't check how much money you had before he turned the water into wine. You want wine? What kind of money you got?
Alonzo Bodden will be at Levity Live in Nyack tonight and tomorrow, two shows. Go to alonzobodden.com for more information. Thank you, Alonzo.
David, this was really fun. I appreciate it. I love the long-form interview and you allowing me to talk and catch up with my friend and be funny.
Soltanovich joins us. She's in Los Angeles. I'm in New Jersey today at my sister's.
Oh, how's your sister?
I wouldn't know. She's my sister. I don't know what she's really like.
No? Guys don't share and get personal and do, like, you know, sleepover kind of sleeping bags on the floor and share secrets and light a candle and then pass the candle. Whoever has it has to tell a deep, dark secret. And then you braid each other's hair and do nail polish and then talk about, you know, how many fingers you've had inside of you that day. No?
Well, that, of course.
That's not a thing?
Yeah, of course.
I don't know. I don't have a sister. I'm guessing.
I just do that with strangers, don't you?
That's true. How else are you going to get to know people on the bus? That's the way to get to know people. You know, we're all in this together, guys.
If I were a girl,
uh-huh,
and we were friends, what would we talk about?
Well, are you a girl who has kids?
I can be any girl you want, Kira. Let's say, yeah, I'm a girl who is an empty nester.
Oh, so you have kids. They're just older, but you remember what cracked nipples are like. So we can talk about that. I would show you mine and say, does this look infected? Is this normal? Are they supposed to be, like, lacerated down from top to bottom like this? And then you would, you know, take a close inspection and offer up some sort of healthy salve, S-A-L-V-E. And we talk about, you know, farm to table and artisanal cheese, you know. Girl stuff.
Now, you told me that with your first baby, your breasts made artisanal cheese. That if you waited 2 days and didn't breastfeed,
yep,
you could squeeze out artisanal Kira Soltanovich cheese.
Yeah, which, you know, sounds awesome. But remember, some of those come with like a thick skin. So, you know, I think there's like a brie and a couple of goudas that have that kind of thick, waxy layer. Mm-hmm. And again, it's all fun and games until that waxy part comes out.
So,
you know, you're the life of the party. Everyone wants you at their, you know, bris until that happens.
I'm trying to get a handle on you because
yeah,
you're doing a million different things. You had to push back this interview because you were in traffic, driving around Los Angeles. You've got two kids, a husband, and I keep apologizing to you. I keep saying, I'm sorry, we'll do this around your schedule. And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, how does she do this? How does she do this? You sound so happy, and I'm forgetting something. You're running on oxytocin, right? You're happy.
I don't have that kind of budget. I'm running on OxyClean, which is just a zit medication that I sniff. Because the oxytocin, you need a prescription, and a person has to, you know, talk to you about it. Obamacare, thanks a lot, right? But OxyClean is just over-the-counter zit medication with a smaller kick, but worth it. If you rub that stuff on your gums, wow, say goodbye to the rest of the afternoon. Woo, 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 woo. Hold on to your hats and glasses, right?
Well,
loose change everywhere because you're flying around.
The thing that I need to understand is, you know, I don't have kids anymore. I don't have babies.
Yeah.
And I just look at you, what I believe is objectively, and I'm thinking, she gets no sleep, she gets some help from her husband, but she's still responsible for two babies, and she has to be funny. Where does she find the time? Where does she find the time? And as I talk to you, I realize, oh, that's right. That makes you happy, that you produce some kind of chemical in your basement. I think it's called crystal meth.
Right. Crystal is the name of my daughter, yes. Well, the truth is, here's the absolute truth. Here's the truth. I think, like most of life, and this could even be comedy, and this can even be most people's careers, right? The reason I had to push back a little bit was because I did a game show table read this morning in Beverly Hills, and I was talking to one of the execs. And I said, you're really great at this. You know, this is you. You're such a great executive. Because you rarely see those. You know, most of them are just douchebags whose dad was, George Burns's lawyer, you know, and that's how he got into the business. But this guy is like really great, you know, and he's like 20% is awesome. And the rest is 80% of like the BS, the paperwork and the legal meetings and HR because somebody fingered a secretary by accident. And so that's kind of like stand-up too, if you think about it, right? Like when you're on the road and you have a layover in Denver and it's delayed for 3 hours because of weather and you finally get to your gig and scratch your armpit, Alabama, and then you're on stage, then you're like, finally, This is when I'm having a good time. All the other stuff, all the other, like, checking into your Red Roof Inn and all the other stuff is just like, ugh, the stuff that makes me personally very sweaty. Like, I'm always sweaty. Always, always. There's no time where I don't have a little bit of pee in my pants and a lot of sweat. That is my life. It's constant. Just the tiniest bit of urine, not a lot, not like a disgusting, you know, kicker off this United flight urine. Just the tiniest, like, where you kind of sniff and you go, that's, well, okay. And then you move on, right? So no one lingers. And then sweat. I'm constantly sweaty with a little bit of pee in my pants. And that's just, and if you're okay, like, that's your baseline, then everything else after that is, you know, normal. That's where I'm working from. That's where I start my day at. Even if I showered, by the way, even if I was lucky enough to take a shower by myself with no one else in the room with me, you know, knocking on the shower door, hurry up, which is everyone else in my house is constantly hurry up. Even if it's by myself and I'm showering, I'm getting all the spots that you need to get, you know, it doesn't matter. The minute I get out, someone is screaming, something has happened, a fire needs to be put out. And the sweat comes back and I pee a little. It doesn't matter. No matter how many times I scrub myself clean. It's what I have to live with. And so that's just my reality. So I work from there. And I thank you for the compliment, because it is a very nice compliment that you gave me, like somehow I make it work. But, you know, you know, if you can make it work with just a little bit of something in your pants, you'd be, you know, you'd learn how to do it. Just the reality. I wish I could sugar. I wish I could lie. I can't lie.
So, yeah. The way I justify the urine in my pants is I grew up with a lot of dogs, and they want to demonstrate their territorial imperative by peeing in certain, you know, they mark. And whenever I see people, I figure I have really nice underwear that they really want to steal. So like a dog, I mark my underwear.
Right, right.
So it's they know
so
it's mine.
Let me tell you, my I don't wear underwear, so what do I do? You know?
Anything, that's another... anything you want. You can do anything, go anywhere you want.
Well, I'm just saying, like, you know, it's now I got to go from that place and move ahead.
Do you?
You know, I have to...
Do you have this
protection?
Do you have this nagging worry that this is the best year or 2 years of your life, that you have the babies, that you're running around, this is the happiest you're ever going to be?
If this is the happiest, I will hang up with you and just drive to Mexico and be gone. If this is it, I will be so, look, I know that's probably, people are like, oh, that's a bad mother. No, if this is the happiest, then I probably should leave now and give them a chance at maybe a good mother, you know, let my husband remarry and find someone who's into regular artisanal cheese, not, you know, from her nipples, just the over-the-counter stuff. I hope this isn't it, but then again, you know, you talk to people in their 70s and they talk about, you know, these times with, oh, just such love in their hearts of like, oh, those sleepless nights. I would do anything for those again. No, you wouldn't. There's no way. People lie. People are lying all the time. And that's one of the injustices of the world, is that we are okay to lie all the time. Because it's in our advertising. There's a hot chick in a bikini eating a Carl's Jr. Are you kidding? She wouldn't even date a guy named Carl. She's not going to eat a burger from Carl's Jr. while she's washing your Volvo. She doesn't care that you drive a Volvo. You know what I mean? It's all, we're all living in this lie. This lie of a bikini, Carl's Jr. bubble bath. It's all a lie. And I can't be part of it. I have to tell the truth.
You have how many kids right now?
Two.
How old are they?
6 and almost 2 years old.
The last time you were on the show, you taped a stand-up special while you were pregnant. So that it's
I sure did.
Has it been 2 years?
Can you believe that? bananas, right?
It's been 2 years. And do you hear a tapping sound?
I don't. Would you like me to?
I hear a little clicking sound all of a sudden.
Well, as a Russian, I definitely could be tapped. So we might want to just be careful what we say from here on out.
Wait, it stopped. But there definitely was a clicking sound.
Yep, that was probably Dimitri checking in.
Or we had a conference call with the Swahili embassy.
Yeah, who have been calling me nonstop, and I'm not even kidding about that. I signed up for something recently, I forget what it was, but I made the mistake of putting my real phone number in, and now I just constantly get phone calls from, like, everybody. You know, with an Indian accent saying they are the IRS, and it's just driving me crazy. So please, anyone listening, do not put your real number in. Ever.
And Kira's real number is 555-818-555-5555. All right, so
it was the biggest mistake.
So let's review, because you haven't been on the show for a while. Last time we talked, we were promoting a Mother's Day show. I believe you were doing it in Irvine and taping a show while pregnant.
Close. It was in Orange County. It was a little further down south in Irvine, but yes. San Luis.
And the name of that special is?
You Did This to Me.
You Did This to Me. Did you do a kickstart with that?
I did. I raised some of the money through a crowdfunding, and I let people who, you know, donated a lot of money do really cool stuff. One of them was for $25,000, you could cut the cord.
I remember this.
And you remember that. And for $20,000, you could help us name our baby. And we did get someone with that.
Oh, wow. So nobody cut your cord?
No, my husband did it.
You didn't wait. I figured you would wait, because I think the longer you wait to cut an umbilical cord, the more people would pay, right?
That's true, yeah. But, you know, they really frown upon that when you leave the hospital. You know, like, they really, like, they're kind of like, leave the messy trail.
Hey, let me ask you a question about this. I want to find, first of all, what's your baby's name?
Igor.
Seriously?
Well, the Russian mafia did give me money for my special, and that is 100% true. That is 100% true.
The Russian mafia gave you money?
They gave me $20,000, yeah. I really do owe them money back. So if people could please go watch it now. I wish I was kidding, and people don't believe me when I say this, because they're like, ah, ha, 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 very funny. No. I really do owe them a lot of money. So if you could please go to Amazon now, after listening to the rest of this, then go please watch it on Amazon.
And what is the name of it?
You Did This to Me.
And you had a boy?
Girl.
That you named, who you named Igor?
Igor. Well, like I said, the Russians, they're the ones that contributed.
All right. In all seriousness, is it really Igor?
No, it's not. Okay. It's Claire.
Oh, okay.
You got me.
Okay. And she's two, and the other one, I believe, is a boy.
Yes.
And so you have a boy and a girl. The ages are 2 and 6. That's a good age range for a boy and
it's
a baby.
It's great.
For a baby sister.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Let me get back to the umbilical cord. I'm being serious. How long?
Okay.
How long could you go attached by the umbilical cord?
I think that they like the umbilical cord to stop pulsating after the baby's born, to stop pulsating before you cut it, because they're still receiving blood from the placenta. So they like to cut that.
But if you decided,
maybe 2-3 minutes.
If this were a reality show that I was pitching to that executive who you really like, and I want his name after the show because I want to pitch this.
Yeah.
How long? We'll call it Mama's Boy. Where it's a reality show where a boy is never separated from the umbilical cord. Can that be done? Mm-hmm. In all seriousness, how long could you go?
Okay, so in all seriousness, this is a little bit of now, if people tune out because there's too much biology and medical stuff happening, that's on you. But in all seriousness, after the baby is born, right, your uterus should start contracting and getting smaller and smaller and smaller because you have to deliver the placenta.
Where's my uterus?
It's on you. When I've seen you in person, I feel like it's that hump on your back.
Mm-hmm.
But everyone, I guess, has a different place for it.
I'm Igor.
But in most women, after you deliver the placenta, right, because it's attached to the umbilical cord, are you assuming the placenta is staying inside of the woman's body?
I'm trying to remember. I do remember the placenta.
You have to deliver that as well.
So you cannot let go of the placenta.
Well, your uterus has to shrink back down. Your uterus has to now basically contract some more into its original shape.
Oh, hang on for 1 second. I'm being serious here.
Yeah.
So, yes. Okay. So you're giving birth, and mm-hmm. the first thing that comes out of you is the placenta.
I hope not. I hope it's the baby.
The baby?
I really do. But okay. If your baby looks like a placenta, which could happen, they'll eventually, you know, probably grow out of that.
Okay, so the baby comes out. That I remember.
Yes. Okay.
And I remember the umbilical cord, and then they bring the placenta. Do they cut the umbilical cord before removing the placenta, or does the placenta come out and then they cut the umbilical cord?
The placenta is usually delivered right after the baby. It's really like they call it, it's another delivery because you have to like push it out. Like you have contractions and it's a miracle.
No.
Disgusting, bloody miracle. But yeah, they push the placenta out, and that's the part that's attached to your body.
So,
but now it's not anymore.
Do you remember the Apollo program? The race to the moon?
I mean, yes, I wasn't around then, but I know what it is. Yes.
Okay, so the placenta would be like the service module, and the baby would be the command module that is attached to the
right.
service. And then before reentry, you get rid of the service module and then go into the Earth's
kind
atmosphere.
Of, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, sure. Sure.
And the placenta is kind of the passageway between the service module. It's the connecting wires between the placenta and the command module.
Yes.
Okay.
And also a great name for a young black female rapper. Just throwing it out there if anyone's brainstorming right now.
All right, back to my question. So the placenta comes okay. out, and it's still attached
yes.
to the umbilical cord, right?
Right.
But it's not attached to you.
No, you deliver it. It detaches from you, and it's bye-bye.
And how does it stick to you when it's in you? Are there
double stick tape or like a you know, like that tacky tape that doesn't mm-hmm. leave a mark on the walls, that kind of stuff.
So you got to go up there. Who makes sure it
attaches to the uterus? Yeah, it's attached to the uterus. It's pretty amazing.
Okay,
so the uterus is like a balloon, right?
Right.
The baby is like the air, so it fills up the balloon. Once you let the air out, which is the sound that I make now every time I go upstairs. And then the uterus goes back like a balloon would when it's, you know, deflated from the air. It never looks the same as it did when you took it out of the package, but it's deflated now.
But you have been on stage with your uterus making uterus animals, like balloon
uh-huh.
animals.
Yeah.
And
right.
I find it appropriate, but people say it's, I don't know, that you shouldn't be doing it.
Well, because comics look down on prop comics. But you know what? F you. I have to make a career. I have a mortgage. I have a mortgage.
All
I don't
right.
care what your judgment is.
Okay, so the placenta comes out. The umbilical
uh-huh.
cord is still attached to it. Right?
Right.
The baby is
yes.
still getting nutrients from the placenta, even sure. though you're no longer servicing the placenta.
Right. But then slowly it will start to die off like a Baywatch babe's career. Where nobody cares about it anymore. It's getting old and shriveled. And
okay, so
that's it. It's done.
If you don't cut the umbilical cord, you just say, you know, if let's say we do this. We say, you know what? We've had a couple of kids. Let's have one just to see what happens.
Sure.
And we say, hey, we're going to see what happens. Let's not cut the umbilical cord. Does it eventually fall off?
Well, it will turn into basically just like a huge kind of a goiter type of situation where it just starts to rot and deteriorate. It's gross.
Okay.
I don't think that's a reality show with more than one episode, and it might actually only go to the first commercial break.
Well, Hardee's,
and get canceled.
Hardee's says they would sponsor this with their new placenta.
Oh, okay. Well, hey, who am I to? Please. Right. Go where the money is.
And then we dip the placenta in some kind of nutrient.
Oh.
Then it would keep it, right? Like a Miracle-Gro type of situation.
Yeah, I see what you're saying now.
Has anybody ever tried? Go ahead.
I mean, I ate my placenta.
Yes.
I really did.
I know. They're delicious.
Well, but what if that's the show also? You just slowly just snack on your placenta, and then when you're done snacking on it, then you cut the cord and the kid, yay, go to college.
Or it doesn't have to be a reality show. It could be a game show where we serve Chef Ramsay and maybe, you know, Anthony Bourdain, three, you know, Emerald. We feed them celebrity placentas, and they have to guess which celebrity.
Guess. Oh, my gosh, that's genius.
Well, let's not, on the surface, but we have to put it through the development paces to see if it'll work.
Well, but you should still register that. You should still.
I'm already registered. When it comes.
Yeah.
I'm already registered.
A sex offender? No, that's a patent pending on that idea. That is so genius. And then you could, like, because Tori Spelling, I think, is pregnant again with her 12th kid. And so she'd be up for that. That'd be a great one. You could taste it like, oh, it's bitter. It's a bitter placenta.
Now, I noticed, well, by the way, this is the truth. Both my kids, we took pictures of the placenta. And I made the nurse both times hold up the placenta like it was a fish, like it just like she caught something. And
yeah,
I'm being serious. And the first nurse was laughing hysterically. The second one just wanted no part of me. But let me ask you about this. I saw things during childbirth that when I was a young boy looking at Playboy. And then you would tell me that, you know, in 10 years, I will be looking at the same thing and it won't be the same thing. You would have convinced me that I would never want to be near that again. And yet, there's something in human nature where you see something and it's clinical and then, you know, a couple of days later, you're ready to do it, you know, get back in there again.
Sure.
I'm being serious. So that's the biology.
I'm with you 100%. I am. Oh, my gosh. I mean, how many times have I had Russian food? And Russian food can be really delicious and great. But then you see how, like, it looks like it's already been chewed some of the time. And it's so many different colors and textures. And you're like, why would I ever eat this again? And then next thing you know, you're at your grandma's house the next day and you're eating it again. And it's like, it's, you see how it's made and it's disgusting. And the soup, the Russian soup, what we're known for, borscht, the most, looks like murder. I mean, it's red. It's a bowl of red. It looks like a bowl of blood. And you're like, why would I ever? And then there I am lapping it up. I get it. I get it. You don't want to see what it's, you know, before and after and potential is, but then it's so good. It makes you feel good. It's home. It's your childhood. You know, it's the first time you snapped one off or whatever you call it.
So while you're giving birth, are you thinking never again? And why would you think about the Holocaust while you're giving birth? Why?
You know, while you're giving birth, you think you're the only person on the planet that is experiencing the amount of pain that you are experiencing. Meanwhile, it happens a trillion times a day. But in that moment, you're like, nobody knows. No, I got it bad. Like, the second kid I did with zero drugs, nothing. I just popped her out through the lobby. You know, did your wife have them through the sunroof or the lobby?
We did United Airlines. Burly guys came in and just dragged the baby out, kicking.
Dragged the baby out. Oh my god! And the baby's crying. Oh, that is that. Of all the stuff on the internet, and there's a lot of bad stuff on the internet, that really, there's some sort of visceral reaction I got to that.
All right. Well, I want to get back to childbirth, but go ahead. Because I had a visceral reaction, and you're not going to like it.
What is it?
Well, let me hear yours first, because yours is probably sane and not borderline personality.
You mean the United incident recently?
Yeah. What was your visceral reaction?
Of course, we don't know what led up to this. We're just getting the information that it was overbooked. They started volunteering people because no one was volunteering, and they dragged this guy out. That's all we're getting, unless you were on the flight or whatever you happen to know.
Mm-hmm.
Either way, I want that to happen to the guy that takes his socks and shoes off next to me on a United flight. I am more than happy to have that guy dragged off the plane because now I have to stare at his dead toenails for 6 hours to JFK. That I think is okay. But someone who is forced off a plane, whether he's a doctor or not, he just wants to get home, whatever, or he wants to go to his next destination. That the dragging of someone that supposedly was pretty innocent, it just makes me feel like our society is so, it's just a constant mirror held up, like, we are screwed, we are screwed, we are screwed. It's constantly mm-hmm. like, oh, guess what? Here's another reason we are screwed. Mm-hmm. And then here's another reason we are screwed as a society. Like, and I'm not just saying Americans, I'm saying Earth. You know, it's just jacked up. But that's my first reaction. Why? What did you think? He deserved it?
Nobody deserves anything.
Okay.
But we have an unwritten social compact now when it comes to airlines. It's a lot like the donkey show in Tijuana. And I'm being serious. You and I once went, I don't know if you remember, you were opening for me at the San Diego Improv, and I said to you, you were single at the time, and I said to you, hey, you're very attractive, let's go to Tijuana, it's right across the border, I want to show you Tijuana like you've never seen it before. Do you remember this?
Was there ever a San Diego Improv?
Just go along with me. So I take you to the...
Yes, of course. I remember it. Of course, yeah. I have a dream journal just about that incident.
And I take you to the donkey show, okay?
Yeah.
We go to the donkey show, and the donkey got sick during the show. And they stopped the show. The veterinarian said, "This we can't go on." And I wanted my money back because I didn't see the lovemaking, the beautiful, you know, embrace of...
Right.
And the man said to me, when you come to a donkey show, all bets are off. And I said, I'm not betting on the donkey show. That's for the cockfight after the donkey show. I wanted to see a woman and a donkey. And he said, the donkey got sick. Read the small print. That's... You don't get your money back. That's the donkey show. and that's okay. pretty much flying United Airlines. You went into the donkey show, and whatever happens, happens. Keep your mouth shut. It's no matter what, it's an indignity. Just do what you're told. And so I kind of felt, yes, I know a normal human being looks at that video and says, oh my God, this is horrible. We live in a corporate fascist state. But I'm thinking, if you're a doctor and you got to see your patients and you're running around like that on an airplane, maybe you shouldn't be seeing patients. Maybe you're not so mentally stable now, in the emergency room.
Hold on. What is a doctor supposed to wear on a flight going to Kentucky? I mean, they're going to Kentucky. There are no rules in Kentucky. I'm surprised they didn't have overalls on without an undershirt. I mean, come on. I can understand we're flying to Paris, France. Okay. You know, I'll even wear underwear for that flight. Mm-hmm. But Kentucky, we can't expect them to wear anything except for like a gun holster and a Nazi swastika. I don't understand these rules. I don't agree with you at all.
He did not look like a doctor. If he had dressed like a doctor, then they would have treated him with respect.
That's ridiculous.
He was dressed ship to shore.
Okay, well, here's the thing. I can't ever criticize anyone on what they're wearing because, like I said, as a mom of two kids, I leave the house as if I have landed somewhere and the airline lost my luggage. I always look half disheveled. Like, I would look better, but they lost my clothes, so I have to wear this jet ski pack and flip-flops. Like, I always look like a hot mess. So that's not nice at all. And I think there's no way you're joking. And by the way, that donkey, they usually put zebra stripes on it and call it a zebra. So your story doesn't hold water at all. I don't know if it's United, and there's always someone in the news, always United, Delta. I just feel like these cabins are not just pressurized. They are like, it's not just pressurized for our, you know, breathing. It's pressurized with like this stress of whatever everyone is holding on to. It's now we're like sealing it in to this plastic tube, and we're all sitting in it for however long it takes to get wherever. And I think it's creating crazy people. I really do. These flight attendants are all lunatics. I don't think it's their fault. I think they are breathing farts all day long, and that cannot be good for you. I mean, think about it. I'm not a doctor, obviously, as per David Feldman, because I'm wearing yoga pants right now, and, you know, I can't be a doctor. But I do think there's something to be said. They're flying all day long, smelling people's secretions, and
yes.
I just know there's something medical in there that could be driving them crazy.
I agree with you.
Turning them into crazy people.
It's methane poisoning.
I think so.
Is there, maybe we can patent something where you attach something to every passenger's methane emitter.
Yeah.
That kind of goes up into the upper bin and into the atmosphere.
That's not a bad idea.
Where, you know, you sit down, I'm just throwing this out there, maybe every seat on an airline is fitted with this 8-inch methane inhaler.
Okay.
And when you sit down, you gently sit down in this methane inhaler. It's about 8 inches. You would probably make it ribbed and...
I see where you're going with this.
And what?
You got me. I was all on... I've been, like, drawing out schematics while you're talking.
Well, draw it out. And then you sit in your chair, and there's this 8-inch methane.
And then you have to get up to get something to drink, and then you have to sit back down, and then you got to get up to get some more snacks, and you sit back down. Is that the joke, David Feldman?
No,
I've been
I'm
taking
just
you seriously this whole time.
I'm just saying that, and then everybody, I know a lot of people would sit very quietly and just read.
Yes, they would. But now you can't even smoke on airplanes. So
yeah, but that would calm a lot of people down. The methane inhaler, the 8-inch rock ribbed methane inhaler. The bumpy flights would probably put some people to sleep. The air would be cleaner.
You'd bring on the turbulence. You say more, please. More turbulence.
This is your captain speaking. Buckle in. We have a bumpy.
I feel like we made a lot of headway here.
Yes,
I feel like we solved some world problems.
We did. Before we wrap it up, this is the happiest time of your life. It really is. You're going to look back. What happens as you get older and the kids start going away is you play act the idea of empty nest, but you can't imagine it.
Right.
But you say, oh, this must be what it's like for other people to have an empty nest. But that's never going to happen to me. That's impossible because my relationship with my kids is special. And then one day they're gone. And you go, and everybody my age who's gone through this, they all say the same thing. They say, what the hell was that? Like the thing with the kids? They say, what? I have this friend, Christopher, who dropped his youngest daughter off at college, and he was done, you know? He says, that's it. And he turned to his wife and said, what the hell was that? What were the all those kids, 25 years of raising kids, we just dropped the last one off at college. What the hell was that? And you immediately, you feel cheated. It's a bait and switch. Because in America, we're a nation, baked into our people is leaving the homeland. You left your homeland. Your parents said goodbye to Russia. My grandparents, all four of them, said goodbye to Eastern Europe. They never looked back. That's who America is. We don't, and so then the kids come here and they look at their parents and they say, I got to get out of here. I got to leave. And they leave and they don't come back because that's what Americans do. We're a lonely people. So we have these kids.
Well, now I feel terrible.
Your kids are hardwired to immigrate to, you're in California, they're going to fall in love with Chicago or New York because we're a nation of immigrants.
You just made me so sad.
But I'm telling
you. I'm going to have to go find my methane comforter.
Did I make you sad?
No, you're speaking the truth. It makes sense. I get it.
I mean, here's the thing. I was right. I didn't want my kids going away to college. I said, there's no reason for them to go away to college. Let them stay home and go to college here. And they said, well, you won't let go. You won't let go. That's right. I'm not going to let go. Why should I let go?
Yeah. Yeah.
So they can go off to some college and drink and not study and worry about sex and their clothing when they can stay home and I can still do my parenting. I think kids should leave the house at 32. I'm serious. And I know you're laughing at me. I think that we're all going to be living, our kids are all going to live to be 150. What is 32 years of parenting? Is that going to kill you to let me parent you for 32 years instead of 18? They came up with the idea of sending kids off to college when they were 18 because they didn't live that long. But kids are living much longer now. I should be able to parent my kids until they're 32, 35, or 40. Moses wandered in the desert for 40 years. The Jews didn't find, it's Passover week. The Jews wandered in the desert for 40 years, partly to avoid the tolls, but mostly you don't come into your own. I just did a joke for my act there, Kira. And I got nothing.
I don't mind.
I
don't mind. Here's the thing. I think that 18 is too young in all seriousness. I think it is way too young. But that's all we have budgeted for. And to be honest with you, it's more like 15 and a half. So fingers crossed. Fingers crossed we have like a Doogie Howser situation on our hands and he's off to Harvard Medical School at 16. And then he's their problem. Speaking of, hold on one second. I have my six-year-old. Yes? What would you like?
Yes.
Almost done. Almost done. Mommy's career is very important.
All right.
Okay.
By the way, my son is off in Germany drinking six packs of Canadian. He's Doogie Howser. Hoser. Doogie, I made a bad joke. Doogie, I don't know. Let's plug some
Hoser,
gigs.
Hoser.
I screwed that joke.
Hoser. No.
I don't know. That's no good. Let's plug some gigs. Where are you going to be?
When is this coming out?
It will be out Friday morning at 3 a.m. Our podcast comes out every Tuesday and Friday at 3 a.m. And I understand you have a new podcast.
I do. It's called Karen and Kira Can Read. And I don't know if you're into this kind of stuff, but it's Karen Rentowski and myself giving fellow comedians readings.
Oh, because Karen's all into the ghost stuff.
Yeah. We have today Jackie Cation is our guest, and it's a good one. It's a really good one. So have a listen. You can find us on iTunes or wherever you listen to your podcasts. Karen and Kira Can Read, and of course my show that you have kindly been a guest on. This is my name, the Kira Soltanovich Show. I talk to, again, fellow comics. I love comedians. I just love them.
I do, too.
And we talk about our kids and how they cock block our careers. Yes, I talk about you, mister. I'm going to be doing the goddamn comedy jam Tuesday, April 25th in Hollywood, California at the Roxy.
Wow.
So that's what I'm plugging right now.
Good for you. Go enjoy your son.
Thank you so much. I should give him food.
You are so funny. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. David Feldman. I appreciate you.
I appreciate you, too. You're brilliant. Thank you.
Okay, talk to you soon. Bye.
Hi. Hello.
Hi, Mr. Irrera.
Yes, is this Felda the Clown?
Well, no, this is his producer, Cap Bemelman. I'm rolling, by the way.
Oh, you are? Okay.
This is Cap Bemelman. I'm the segment producer for the David Feldman Show.
Yeah, yeah, I hear a lot of great things about it from David.
Yeah, and I just want to say I'm a little nervous talking to you because this is my first job in podcasting,
mm-hmm.
and I'm a big fan of yours. I've never done a pre-interview with somebody of your stature before. So,
well, I want you to look at me as just a regular guy who happens to have more credits and talent than most people. I'm down to earth. I'm proud of being down to earth.
Okay.
I was number 79 in Comedy Central's list of 100 greatest comedians of all time. That includes the Byzantine era, the Ming Dynasty. You know, I'm up there. I was number right after Cedric the Entertainer. Do you have any questions?
Yeah. Should we talk about you being the 79th greatest?
Nah, I don't want to talk about it. It has a sore spot in my heart. I felt like I should have been 74.
Who do you think didn't belong on the list?
Jeanine Garofalo. Not funny, I say to thee.
Do you ever get... It's David Feldman. I'm the master of disguise, Dom. I had you going.
David, holy... Man, I had no idea.
I got you. I got you.
You did, man. You're in New York, huh?
I'm in New York. Are you in Philadelphia?
I am. I'm here. I was at a wedding. I do weddings now. No, I was with my family. Imagine having a comedian at a wedding. What a drag that would be. Everybody wanted to talk. And I'm doing something for the University of Pennsylvania. I don't know, with Lou Schneider. You know Lou?
I know Lou. Yeah. Is it a show for the University of Pennsylvania or a benefit?
I think it's like they show some film clips of my illustrious career, and then they Lou interviews me, and then I guess there's a question and answer period.
For those of you who don't know who Lou Schneider is, Lou is a great comedy writer. I think he's working on the Goldbergs, but he was one of the top guys on Everybody Loves Raymond, and very early on, he was cute and adorable, and his stand-up took off very early on, but then he gave it up.
Well, I wouldn't say it took off. There must be another word. It fizzled. That's what the word is. Fizzle. I knew it was close to taking off. It stayed on the launch pad and just...
And you're in Philadelphia. I'm actually in New Jersey. I'm at my sister's house for the holidays.
Get the fuck out of here. get that bullshit. Now, is your sister, I meant to ask you, is your sister busty?
Yeah. You remember her.
Well, you know, everybody remembers her, but I just was trying to get her straight.
She's very busty, but there's no cleavage. It's just like this big thing.
Big ribs, yeah.
Yeah, and it's everywhere. It knocks things over.
Mm-hmm. It's got a mind of its own, I'd say.
How long did you go out with my sister?
Well, I never went out with her. I would go in, you know, like into a closet or... Well, booths at the in those days they had telephone booths, and I would spray my seed on her, and you know, tell her to go forward and multiply or whatever the fuck she's doing.
This is what you, when you say spray your seed, you mean you were gardening and.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Oh, okay, because that's my sister you're talking about.
Oh, I know that. I respect that.
She is busty. She's had difficulty. I'm trying to fix her up with a guy, if you know anybody. I mean, you don't want to see her anymore, do you?
You know what? I really don't, because I'm still itching from the last time I saw her. But yeah. Tell her, you know, I enjoyed the time together. And it, plus, she looked too much like you. Looked like you with long hair, and didn't work out for me.
Yeah.
And by the way, thanks for that ride from Flappers back to go Hollywood. I think you got out of town right after that escapade.
Uh-huh. I was playing Flappers, or you were playing Flappers, and I said, I'll give you a ride to the Comedy Store. And what happened? I got pulled over by the cops, right?
No, your car broke down in the parking lot.
But didn't I get pulled over, too? Didn't the cops come? Weren't you blowing me in the parking lot?
Yeah, with the cop. Remember they made me sit in the car? What the fuck was that about? They made me sit in the cop car. I said, I got a spot at the store. Why am I sitting here? Then they let me go. That was so fucking weird.
Yeah.
Does this interview make any sense to anybody?
No, but some of it's true and some of it's not. But we did. Was it the cops? Didn't the cops pull me over?
Yeah, but they couldn't have pulled you over because you were in the parking lot. Maybe they did pull. You know what? I think you made a U-turn and they pulled you over.
Right, and you kept saying, I'm Dom Irrera, I'm Italian, not black, let me go. Sometimes they confuse my people with black people, but rest assured, I'm Italian, not black.
I'm Sicilian, not Ethiopian.
Something happened. I think I've blocked it out. And so you're in Philadelphia for a wedding, and you had dinner with Dr. Katz and his wife.
I did. He told me the episode with you and David Tell was terrific.
It was. It really is. And
Dave's so funny. You know, he was on my podcast, and he said at the end of the podcast, we're just like kind of wrapping up, and we weren't on the air anymore. I said, Dave, I don't think you realize how strong you are sometimes. He goes, Dom, I hate my act, but most of all, I hate myself. I said, yeah, you know what? I said, that's why you're still funny. Keep on hating.
I've never been funnier. I know you can't tell right now. And that's not
but you know what you do? You hold back a lot. You're the master of the hold back.
But I am miserable, and I do feel I'm funnier that when I was happily married and went home to a loving house with kids and a dog and a white picket fence and three boys tied up in the basement.
Oh.
Remember those boys?
It's all starting to come back to me like the hot kiss at the end of a wet fist. Now, what's going on? Are you divorced finally, or
I'm getting there. I'm. It's like we're at the finish line, and then somebody just let off a pressure cooker.
Well, what happened? You want to talk about it, or you want to talk about it off the air?
No, I'll talk about it. You know, this is my third wife, and she met this road comic.
You're kidding, right?
Yeah, very popular. They love him in Montreal. They love him in Ireland. Whenever he's on the road, his initials are D.I. I don't know who it is. D.I.
D.I. I don't know.
Yeah. And whenever I came home off the road, there was just little hints that this guy, D.I., was
like D.I. rules carved into the blanket?
Yeah, yeah. And sometimes when we were having sex.
You and him?
No, I don't know.
You and her?
Yeah, she would scream out, Big D, Big D.
Number 79.
That's right. How did you know? She would say, you're the all-time greatest 79th.
David.
Yeah?
I'm the one. I didn't even realize it was your wife I was fucking.
You, D. How do you spell Irrera? Is it Dom Irrera with an I?
I-R-R-E-R-A. Irrera.
You were doing my wife?
Well, I don't know what the hell she was to you, but I was doing her, yeah.
I have to, but you?
She reminded me of a female version of your sister. fleshy, but they really just protruded. I don't know how to explain it to you.
What is the weirdest pickup after a show? What's the weirdest thing a woman... Do you remember the comedian John Fox?
Yeah.
Do you remember him?
Mm-hmm.
Did you get along with him?
Yeah. I didn't do coke or anything, so we didn't have a lot in common, but I got along with him, yeah.
Did you ever hear all the stories about him on the road?
Most of the stories I heard were drug stories. Well, you got, sexual stories?
Yeah, but wasn't there a plan to collect all those stories and do a documentary? Or you don't sound too thrilled about this, I can tell.
No, I don't know that much about him. I know that he was like a really dirty road comic. A lot of people liked him, and he did a lot of coke, and he passed away, right?
Yeah, he passed away. He had the most amazing road stories that were just completely degenerate. And, you know, the classic one is, and it's almost like a joke, but he's in bed with this woman. She asks him to tie her up in a hotel room, and then she says, can you go get something at the drugstore, some kind of lube? And he leaves, and she's tied up, and then he can't remember where the hotel room is.
Oh, shit.
And then finally, like 12 hours later, he remembers what... This sounds like a joke. And then he comes back to the room after 12 hours of her being tied up, and she goes, kinky. That has to be a joke when he told that to me, right? That can't be true.
Sounds like a joke, yeah.
Yeah. So you blew my cover with Jonathan Katz's wife. You told her the truth about me.
I can't believe you're doing some charity event. She had no idea that you were, shall we say, blue. Well, you can work clean, right?
I consider myself a clean act.
Well, I don't care what you consider yourself. You're not a clean act. You can live your delusions all you want.
Do you think of me as dirty?
Yeah, but like more than dirty, like repulsive. That's why I love you.
Wait a second. Don't you think my act brings it to the edge but doesn't go over? Don't you think the audience appreciates that I'm skilled in making them think differently without pushing them away?
First of all, what audience? You realize even your engineer is not listening to us right now? How did you get hooked up with Scroven? It had to be like a political thing, right?
Steve Scroven and he started hanging out at KPFK, the radio station.
Right, yeah. I did that show with you, yeah.
Yeah, and then...
Killed.
Yes, you did. I took 2 days to find the proper burial for that person.
That killing. That bloodfest.
But Steve did the documentary about Ralph Nader, and then Ralph Nader, there are two people in my life who I worship, Dom Irrera.
Thank you. We're on the same wavelength.
And Ralph Nader. So we decided to do a radio show together with Ralph Nader, and it's been...
Okay. Yeah.
Did you ever meet Ralph Nader?
No, but I went to Steve Scroven's birthday, and it was vegan, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it was good and all, but, I mean, his wife, like, it's got to be so annoying to be vegan and annoying to have friends that are vegan, because you just can't go anywhere, you know?
I'm trying. Although, I'm vegan, sort of. I'm vegetarian.
Are you really? Well, yeah. That's a big difference. Does vegetarian mean that you don't eat fish either?
I don't eat fish.
That's pescatarian, right?
Yeah. And I don't... I'll occasionally eat cheese and a headliner semen.
Mmm. I'm hard as a rock. Yeah, I mean, I eat everything, so what does that make me?
A pig?
I'll tell you what, it makes me an American, pal. Better America. Better American cheese. Come on. We can do it. So does all those political upheaval upset you?
I'm kind of tuning it out, quite frankly. At least right now. Because it's... I was talking to Barry Crimmins on the last show about this. And it's
quit
just,
bragging.
Well, he is... I think there are two political satirists who I look up to, Barry Crimmins and Dom Irrera. That's why I called you. I need guidance on how to deal with this turmoil in America. And I spoke to Barry Crimmins, and now I want to get some feedback from you about Trump. And
well, the last thing I remember, my goddaughter was, very, very worried about this election. And I told her, I said, it's impossible that he gets elected. It's absolutely, she goes, are you sure? I go, first of all, I know nothing about politics. And I go, I'm positive. I said, even if he wins a few states, that'll be an upset. I said, do you have nothing to worry about? Of course, the next day he wins the presidency with the Electoral College votes and all that bullshit. Right. But I was stunned, man. I'll tell you, I couldn't fucking believe it.
I couldn't believe it either. My youngest said to me, Daddy, now that Trump's president, are we going to have to round up Muslims and Mexicans? And I said, no, honey, they'll do that for us.
Well, I can't believe the Muslim thing. It's especially now, there's a lot of Muslim comedians, so you get to know the culture and know the people more. And if they were really, if Muslims and terrorists were the same thing, we'd all be dead. You know what I mean? Because there's plenty of them.
When we were starting out, do you think we would make it? Not that you made it, but it sure seems like we had it easy back then. There wasn't that much competition. Like, women didn't do stand-up comedy when we were
especially
starting.
Pretty women. You know, I mean, now we got to see these beautiful young girls that are actually pretty good. You know, Kate Quigley and Jessamay Peluso, and you know some of them.
Maybe
there are some really hot girls that are really good stand-ups now. That started with Laura Keitlinger. I was in Ireland. We were doing a festival, and Laura goes up. She was living with Jack Black at the time, you know, and that was. And she goes up, and she has a really terrible set, and she's very funny. She says, what happened? I said, you're too good looking. You know, it was intimidating to the audience. They don't go for it. They weren't ready for it yet. Now they can handle it more. But she looked like a fashion model on stage, and nobody's going to, you know, have any pathos with that, you know.
Right.
Not in those days.
Right. It was very hard for women back then, especially on the road. It was very hard for them.
Well, yeah, you know, they get the drunken middle act or drunken headliner wanting to fuck them, and they had to, you know, barricade their door. And I remember Tammy Pascatelli telling me how she lived in fear. Imagine living in fear of the other acts. My fear was that they would do their act again. Please, no more. I can't take it.
I'll leave my bedroom door open. You can come in the middle of the night and violate me. I just don't do your act. I beg of you.
No, no, no. I didn't notice. I didn't notice it. I'm sure it's funny if I did.
Do you like a strong middle act? Let me answer this question because I'm curious what you think. I like a middle act who I have to follow, who is working on his act. What I don't want is a filthy act who kills. And what I really don't want is Maria Bamford opening for me. I brought Maria Bamford to San Francisco. It was very patronizing. Oh, you're very funny. We have the same agent. I'm going to take care of you, Maria. I'm going to bring you up to San Francisco, and they're going to fall in love with you.
It was like, remember the movie A Star Is Born? Within within one day, the entire city of San Francisco falls in love with Maria Bamford, but I'm headlining. So now I'm finally selling tickets. I never sold tickets. All of a sudden, they're sellout shows. But when I get on stage, the audience isn't happy. And it dawns on me that
were you headlining or
hosting? Yeah. It dawned on me that, oh, I get it. She's selling all these tickets.
Wow. Yeah, we were in a cartoon together. She played the farmer's wife in a cartoon called Back at the Barnyard. Hmm. And she was fucking hilarious.
Beyond. I mean, she's so good. So I don't like an act who's opening for me who is just brilliant and fantastic and just better on every level.
When you mentioned Jonathan Katz earlier, do you remember a guy named Chris Bliss?
Yeah.
And he did like 15 minutes of basically juggling to the Beatles, not the White Album, the Abbey Road album, that one side where they have all those quick cuts.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not Her Majesty. Me and Mr. Mustard, she came through the bathroom window, all those, you know, once there was a way to get back home. Anyway, he does a juggling thing to this. And Jonathan called me up. He was in West Palm Beach. He goes, Dom, what do you do when your opening act doesn't get just a standing ovation, a leaping to their feet ovation? How do you follow that? You know, I mean, because it was like a remarkable moment. And the guy, it was the only thing that he could really that separate him from the pack. You know, as a comedian, he was a regular comedian. He's a nice guy, pleasure to work behind because he's not too strong, but professional.
Mm-hmm.
But as a juggler, a funny juggler, he was just unbelievable. Oh, fuck. This is my other phone.
You got a call?
Yeah.
This is insight into show business. Who's the call from?
Probably a talent scout who saw me recently. He's going to get me out of this drudgery. David, I hope I make it someday.
Is there anything that would make you nervous right now? If you got a call, is there anything that would make you nervous when it comes to stand-up? Is there a gig you'd say...
If I laughed at a ventriloquist puppet, I would feel ashamed of myself. If I actually got mad at the puppet. Is there anything make me nervous? You know what? I used to open for Cher, right?
I remember.
And I was on the road with her, and I did Madison Square Garden, and my sister was there, and she was nervous. And it got me thinking, maybe I should be nervous. It's not normal not to be nervous. And that got me, oh, shit, I don't want to look up because all the banners are up there with the Knicks and Rangers and all this stuff. And so that's like the most recently I was nervous. That was probably like in the early, late 1990s, you know.
Right.
But that did make me nervous, but not anymore. I mean...
What's the most? So is that the most nervous you've ever been in your life as a stand-up?
No. The most nervous I've ever been by far was the first Tonight Show. First time I did the Tonight Show, Carson was still doing it. And all I wanted to do, I mean, I was in the dressing room. I was not having any fun. I was fucking terrified. I never get headaches. I had a terrible headache. And I looked outside. I saw the hills in Burbank, and I thought, I'll run out of here, and I'll run into the hills and just start a new life, you know, in the hills somewhere. I just had to get the fuck out of there. But I ended up doing okay and all that, but that was really nerve-wracking. It was not fun. They go, just have a good time. You have a good time. You know, it's like, try having a good time in front of all those people in those tiers, those balconies, so looking straight up into the sky, and Johnny Carson and Ed McMahon are 15 feet away from you. That was really scary. Scary. Ooh.
Were you enjoying it while you were doing it?
No, I hated it. I was acting like an act.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to get through it. You know, I worked very hard, and it was a very polished act and all that shit. And No, there was no fun. Like, you know when I had fun? When I used to work with Craig Ferguson, and he was just throw the cards away and just talk, and that was fun. I mean, we would... One time I came out on stage, and he introduced me as going to be in at the Denver Comedy Works. I said, Craig, you really got a crack staff here. I already did the Denver Comedy Works last week. But, you know, I'm hot. I'm so hot. I'm so white hot in this business now, they have to post-plug my dates. So there's riots. Right? So he said, you know, he goes, look, this is taping this. We can stop and you can start over. I said, no, I don't have time for that. Man, I got a spot at the Laugh Factory in an hour. So, you know, the audience knew we were fucking around, but, right. But it was real. You know, I said, because he came over to me during my set, and he's so much bigger than me, which made it look funnier. And I said, look, why don't you go over there in your high seat to look down on people, a la David Letterman, and I'll do my little joke monkey act, and then we'll come over and act like we're friends. And that was, like, fun because, it was real, and maybe we were making each other laugh and all that.
No. But with Carson, there was a time when one shot could not make or break you, but it would definitely move you ahead or way back, right?
It's certainly, you know, for Roseanne and Drew Carey and a couple of people like that, it really helped. I mean, I know I was fortunate enough to be in a Rodney Dangerfield special, and that really was incredible because that was like the Soprano of its times. In the sense that everybody watched that show. Everybody watched the new, you know, Dangerfield's Young Comedians, whatever it was, you know.
Do you mind if I ask you two questions about that? Because I was watching the Rodney Dangerfield documentary, and they showed you doing the Young Comedians special. I could not believe how fully formed you were as both a comic and a man. I was watching, they showed a clip of you. It was your first TV shot, I guess. You were so, I don't want to say polished, but formed and brilliant. And the language, people always forget about you. What a great writer Dom Irrera is. I remember there was a benefit for Ralph Nader's Public Citizen, one of the first.
Oh, yeah, yeah. At UCLA or something
around
there.
Yeah, yeah, and yeah. Steve said, come out. We have all these people from Public Citizen, the people's lobbyists. They're raising money. All these comics went out and did political humor. Their hearts were in the right place. You went out in front of all these, I don't want to say intellectuals, I don't know, just, you know, liberals. And you just did your act. The play, it just destroyed. And the language... all these literary references that you don't pass yourself off as a writer, but you're an amazing writer. Do you sit and write this stuff out?
No, actually, I try and remember what I said, because I'm like you in the sense that I'd rather be funny in the moment, and I'd rather, I just don't have the talent to sit there and write like a real writer like Woody Allen, sitting there from 9 to 5, and I once asked Seinfeld how he does it, and he said that this is years ago, way before his show. He said, what I do is I sit there for 25 minutes with a pad and a pen, and if something comes, great, and if it doesn't, that's too bad, but at least I tried. Mm-hmm. You know, so he had the discipline to do that. I don't even have that. How about you?
Me, it's two separate. If I'm writing, I'm writing. For stand-up, it's got to be something I say in conversation. I have never been able to come up with a joke for my act by sitting and writing. Because stand-up is a conversation with the audience.
Yeah.
So, yeah. That's interesting.
You know what's interesting about stand-up? Oh, go ahead. Finish your
No,
thought.
You go Sorry. Ahead. You go ahead.
I was going to say, the interesting thing about stand-up, and I could feel it happening, was when the audience is relaxed by your body language. Because I remember, like, thinking, Jonathan, for instance, we used to do this place called Nick's in Boston. Mm-hmm. And Nick's was like a mixture of the mob and crooked police. at the time. You know, it was really fun, and they, you know, like it, I said something. I had a ticket for backing up on the expressway in the snow, and about five Irish cops offered to fix the ticket for me after the show. I thought, what a great place where the mob and the police can live in harmony together. You know. But anyway, I don't know what my point was on that, but it was just...
Well, I'm going to
say... Oh, I know, Jonathan. I begged him to do the third show Friday night. Can you imagine, like, a second show Friday night isn't bad enough days to do a third show?
Mm-hmm.
So I said, John, you know, look, let's do the show, and if you're not having a good time, just bring me up, and I'll cover for you, you know. As he walked to the stage, he'd just been introduced... As he walked to the stage, they booed and heckled his bald head. He didn't even say, you know, so he goes up on stage, and they're booing him, right? He didn't even say anything for like about a minute, which is a long time in that, you know, in that kind of state. And after about a minute, he goes, precisely. And he walks off the stage. He walked off the stage without saying anything.
Ah, oh, he's so funny. He is so effing funny. Are you ever in a situation that you can't handle? Or is it just, you know, it's a horrible situation, so you forgive yourself and just enjoy it?
You know, I don't think I get too high or too low. I just think that I figure that I'm at a certain level, not to sound dickish about it, but I figure at this point, if certain material is not doing well that I know works, it's probably not me, but that doesn't mean it can't be me at times, you know. So I don't think I'm so wonderful or so terrible. I just kind of stay in the middle, and
mm-hmm.
you know, I practice so much that I think I have an idea of when I'm phoning it in and when I'm being real, you know. I think that the idea of time is really interesting, because I'll go to the Comedy Store after doing, like, you know, an hour on the road, and that 15 minutes seems so fucking long. You know, like, it's so relative how time is. I remember being on stage.
What do you mean by that? What do you mean?
Well, I don't know, because you're in competition with all these great acts. And when you're on the road, you're more relaxed. Mm-hmm. You know, your opening act, the middle act, and you. And it just doesn't, you know, the hour, you know, seems to be the same as 15 minutes to me at the Laugh Factory or Comedy Store in L.A., you know, when you're up against the very best comedians around, you know. That makes sense?
Yeah. In fact, Attell said something interesting, because my fantasy has always been to live like Attell, to stay in New York and only work the clubs, just to commit 100% to stand-up. I was never able to do that. And he said he didn't really get good until he went on the road, which destroyed what I thought about him. He said it wasn't...
So you thought of him as like a real New York act? And
mm-hmm.
You know Dan Vitale?
I love Dan, yeah.
Bill Hicks, you know who Bill Hicks is, right?
Yeah.
And Dave was like the young comic, and he'd come into this place called the Westway, and he goes, what's it like to make it? And I go, you know, Dave, it's really a relative term. I mean, making it, to some people... To me, making it was being able to do what I love doing and actually make a living.
Right.
I didn't have to be the star of, you know, the Dom Irrera show with a special guest, Dom Irrera, you know, everything. I always think that's the kiss of death, other than Seinfeld. When you name the show after yours, because I was on Damon, and Damon Wayans had a show, and it was called Damon, and I go, oh, yeah, that's a bad sign when you call it after yourself, you know. Although, I guess Roseanne made it. What do you think? Yeah.
Yeah, she made it. Yeah. So, Attell was young and hungry. Was he respectful?
Oh, very, very. He was very humble. He was not the Dave we know today, who's fucking hilarious, you know.
Right.
But not, you wouldn't call him humble, you know.
Was there anybody who worked harder than he did on the New York scene? I don't think so, right?
Well, his writing is incredible. His imagery, you know, like that joke he has about he had a fear of traveling because his parents beat him with a globe. You know, I mean, just like jokes like that are so, they're so like hard to figure, you know.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there were certain guys like Mitch Hedberg.
Right.
Did you know Mitch?
Yeah.
And he used to write jokes that were just come off, you know, come out of nowhere. I had to beg. I used to have this show called Full Frontal Comedy. I don't know if you were on it or not.
I was on, sure.
You did it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because you'd be perfect for that show. Because you can be dirty as you want. You can be politically incorrect as you want. But you don't have to be. I had one black comic come up to me and goes, Dom, I don't say pussy in my act, a motherfucker. I said, you know, I said, what, just because you're black, you think it's mandatory? I said, just do what you do. I want it to be a show that you're free to say whatever you want, just like being mm-hmm. in a club. That's all it was. But anyway, Mitch gets up, and I had to beg to get him on the show. And my producer and I are standing there in the Laugh Factory. We're standing in the back watching, and he does this line. He says, I realize when I practice tennis, no matter how much I practice, I'll never be as good as the wall. Right? And it's just like, what a fucking great image, you know?
Yeah. Hey, I have a memory. Maybe it's incorrect. Did Otto and George do Full Frontal?
They were hilarious, yeah.
George was the dummy. Did
right.
George wear a sailor's outfit?
I think so. Sounds familiar. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. And you know, one time he was late. He was late for the gig, and they followed it from his point of view, you know. So because he was so short, he was like looking up women's dresses and stuff. Hey, nice ass haircut. He's walking. And he comes in, and Otto's all upset. He goes, what are you doing in there? He goes, fuck you, Otto, you cocksucker. Suck that cock. Suck that cock. And he's, you know, he's doing that whole Otto George bit. And he goes, you're nothing without me, you motherfucker. You know, and it was just so funny.
People.
What a tortured soul that poor guy was, you know.
It was one of those things. I remember I worked for Dennis Miller for a long time on the HBO show, and about three times a year he would say to the writers, put on some Otto and George. And he would have, this was before YouTube, and he would have tapes, you know, bootleg tapes of Otto and George, and we would just go down laughing. Just it was the funniest ventriloquist act ever. And I guess you could find it on YouTube. I'm pretty sure that Full Frontal, I remember Otto came out in a sailor's outfit, the little puppet, and he goes, nothing but tits. I can't see a C word from up here. Where's the C? I'm not going to say it. I want to see somebody's C word. And it was just, did you know Otto?
Oh, very well, yeah. One time we were in Montreal, and I was hosting this show, kind of like a, it was kind of the precursor to the Nasty Show,
mm-hmm.
right? And it became like a very big hit up there. But Otto was on, and the strings to the puppet's mouth broke, so he couldn't move his mouth. And you know, there was a band there, and Otto panics, right? And he goes, "Look, I'm sorry." He goes. I think Bobby Slayton was on next. So he goes, Bobby Slayton here. And he just panics. And Rick Messina, who was Drew Carey and Tim Allen's manager and old friend, he says, go talk to him in the back. He likes you, not me. Mm-hmm. So I go to the back. It was so bizarre. The puppet's mouth was completely wide open, and it was like he was giving him surgery. And he was tying the strings, I guess, so that he could connect it so that it could have mobility again. And he actually said to the puppet, he goes, I can't believe of all times you're doing this to me now. You know, embarrassing me. You fucking, you know, and he's having like an argument. And I said, man, Otto. And I walked in, you know, like the guy who has a gun pointed at him, but he knows the guy's not going to shoot him. He walks real slow. Mm-hmm. And so it was like, I go, Otto, you did great. He goes, yeah, Dom. I go, I said, Otto, you don't have to worry. He goes, but I bombed at the end. I said, they think it was a joke. You know, I said, you did great. You don't realize how, you know, you did enough time. And then, you know, he kind of came down off the ledge because of that.
Mm. It was so funny. Rick Messina, at one time, was the most powerful guy in Hollywood. He had Tim Allen. He had Drew Carey, right? It was.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But his favorite act was Otto and George.
I know.
If you asked him, who's your favorite? Who do you wish you could do the most for? He'd say Otto and George.
Yeah.
There's some story.
Yeah,
go ahead.
No, once in a while, you know, I'll be up there on a Sunday watching football, and I'll just put Otto and George on. You know, we're in the middle of this, they're all smoking weed and stuff, and middle of this, you know, watching the games and putting music on and all. And then Otto and George just takes over the room for 20 minutes, and then we go back to our regular lives, you know.
It was
funny.
Otto and, to this day, I can go on YouTube and type in Otto and George, and I, because he's, you know what is so funny about it? He's not even trying. There's no effort. It's just pure.
Remember Steve Sharippa used to run the Riviera, and Otto was on stage. They did an X-rated show at midnight at the Riviera, and Steve is the guy who ended up in The Sopranos and all that big, you know, mm-hmm. half Jewish, half Italian, kind of like tough guy from Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. And he goes, Dom, not for nothing. Look at his mouth. His mouth is moving. He's a ventriloquist. His mouth moves more than mine does when I talk. You know, and he did. He just lost any fucking caring about actually appearing to be a ventriloquist. And he would just talk, and the puppet's mouth would move.
Bobby Bacala. Steve Sharippa became Bobby Bacala in The Sopranos.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I never got past that. I just couldn't believe that they put him in The Sopranos, because I remember him as the entertainment director at the Riviera. You're from Philadelphia,
right?
And you go back there. You still have family there, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw them all Saturday at a wedding.
And we were talking to Tom Ryan last week. He's also from Philadelphia.
I love Tom Ryan, yeah.
There's a character to people.
Great guy, bad complexion, by the way. Just trying to keep the story moving. Go ahead.
There is a personality to Philadelphia. Here's my theory about Philadelphia. The people are very self-conscious that it's not New York. So they lord it over you that they're not Jersey. They're proud that they're not Jersey,
right.
But they're intimidated by New York. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, it's very fair.
So they don't know what their status is. Are you proud of Philadelphia?
Yeah, I mean, because I love it so much, I can also be like embarrassed by the behavior sometime, you know, the some of the sports fans and all that stuff. But we've been, you know, they've picked that apart. They've dissected every bit of that and what the reasons for it and all, but they are tough. I mean, they're brutal, the sports fans here. Excuse me. Sorry, David. Allergies. I think I have, and I know that this is riveting for a show, post-nasal drip, and I'm sure you want to hear more about it, but I don't want to talk about it.
No, tell me about it. What is post-nasal? I always hear about post-nasal drip. What is it?
You know, it's amazing how people don't know when a subject should be let go.
No, I'm serious.
And nobody really wants to know too much about your sinuses.
I'm fascinated.
Hey, how you doing? I got this allergy. Oh, yeah? And then there it goes. And I was like, oh, yeah, yeah. When you get to your post-nasal drip, can we go into a dark corner? And you know, I just put a light blanket on myself and start quietly beating off as you talk about the tickle you have in your throat.
I have a friend who is an ENT, and he says your sinuses are this, it's like the New York City subway system. It's very intricate and involved and Byzantine. And there's
dirty.
And dirty, and there's a filigree.
Smells of piss.
That's exactly what he said. He said, your sinuses, if I went in there, it would smell like piss. He says it just winds around and around and around and around. And that they're fascinating. He says it's the most fascinating part of the head. So post-nasal drip, I've always heard that term. Does that mean things from your nose are dripping to the back of your throat?
Yeah, basically. But I don't think it's from your nose. I think it's from your sinuses. I don't think it's in your nose and goes back that far. And I can't believe I'm fucking answering you seriously on this, by the way. As if I really know. It's my theory on the sinus cavity, if I may.
What's your favorite?
Speaking of cavities.
Yes.
I meant to ask you about your wife something. I'll ask you later.
Do you ever think, you know, one slight adjustment in your life, no stand-up, a wife, kids, a day job? Do you ever think that that could have happened?
You know, I think that because of my slight mental illness, that I would probably not be here if I had to do that, if I had to live like that. I can't believe that I'm fortunate enough to have, you know, quote, you know, as I said before, making it is relative, but I consider that I made it, you know, like I said, you know, a little while back, that just if you make a living doing something you love, you made it, you know.
Mm-hmm. I was...
But I can't imagine, no, I can't imagine that life of, like living in a row home in Philly and going to Westinghouse and working and, you know, wanting to retire when you're 39. I mean, that kind of shit, you know.
Having the boat on the driveway, the fishing boat.
Oh, God. Well, that's really making it.
Living for the weekend? Living for the weekend.
Yeah.
I was with Gilbert Gottfried last week. And this I was telling
myself. I guess I know who picked up the check in that, that scenario.
So my sister and I had dinner Monday and Tuesday of this week, and it was Passover, and we're talking, and I said, you know, I really don't want to do Passover with a certain type of person, you know. And she goes, she knew what I meant. I said, I was with Gilbert the other day. This is a long way of telling you this, but... somehow the Beverly Hills Supper Club fire came up. Do you remember the Beverly Hills Supper Club fire? John Davidson?
It sounds familiar. What happened?
Well, I was sitting with Gilbert and his wife, and I mentioned the Beverly... She said, we want to get John Davidson on Gilbert's podcast, and I said, why don't you dedicate an hour to the Beverly Hills Club Supper fire? And Gilbert loses it when I say that. He starts laughing, and if I make Gilbert laugh, now I'm, you know, my life has meaning. And then she asked about the Beverly Hills Supper Club. And I said, well, it was a fire in 1977. John Davidson was playing there, and the whole place went up in flames, and his band leader died because he ran back into the theater to get his charts are very expensive. If you have an orchestra and you pay for charts, they're like, at that time they were like $40,000. So the word is he ran back in to get the charts, not to save anybody, to just get the charts,
right.
And he died, and as I'm telling her this, Gilbert is laughing hysterically, and I'm the happiest man in the world because I'm talking about the Beverly Hills Supper Club fire. And Gilbert's laughing, and his loving wife is laughing. She's young. She doesn't know about it. And I'm saying to my sister, to me, that's a Passover Seder. You know, I can spend time with somebody. And Gilbert has Passover with Paul Schaefer and that crew. And I'm thinking, I could do that. But I can't sit with normal people. You know, like you described with the job at Westinghouse and the...
Yeah.
I can't sit with normal people, and I can smile and pretend that I can have a conversation with you, but I want to talk about the Beverly Hills Club Supper fire, and if you don't know about it, I want to tell you about it, and I want Gilbert to be laughing hysterically at it. That's what I'm looking for. That's what I find relaxing, and that's always been where I'm at. So I can't sit back. Do you ever, I mean, to me, you're famous, but I would assume that you're in situations where people don't know who you are.
Of course, yeah.
Do you say, I'm Dom Irrera, I'm a comedian, or do you, for just expediency, say, I work at Westinghouse?
I I try never to talk about my act or the fact that I'm a comedian, like on a plane. Like, you know, I never talk about it. I mean, sometimes people... I'll give you a good example, which was really funny. Oliver Stone was sitting next to me on a flight from New York to L.A. And we were in first class, and the flight attendants recognized me, and they kept doing lines from Seinfeld.
Wow.
You know, and they would come, and they you know, bring me a drink and laugh a little, talking about something, you know. Excuse me.
Is that a post? Anyway, that sounds like post nasal drip. Do you have post nasal?
Thank
drip?
You. Yeah. Yes, it is. And I know it's funny how life works. That we were kidding about it. And now I'm actually in a little discomfort, but I don't want to hock one up, you know, because it's very, very unprofessional. But
so you're sitting
anyway.
With Oliver Stone.
Sitting with Oliver Stone.
And during the flight, how were your sinuses? Because the cabin pressure can be murder.
Not bad. You know, you got to remember to chew gum.
Mm-hmm.
Chew something. Chew your cud. But anyway, he only got up one time. We didn't talk the whole flight. And
You said you didn't talk or you did talk?
We didn't. We did not talk at all. But like he noticed that these people were like making a fuss over me and goofing with me. Anyway, at the end of the flight, he said, "Who are you?" And I said, "I was flight attendant of the year." And I said, "Wait till you see when we get to the jetway. I got my own parking space right next to the jetway." And he just went like this. He went, "Oh, uh-huh." And he just kept reading. I wasn't going to tell him I'm a comedian you never heard of. But yeah, it's interesting living a life of at the level I'm at, where I can be like signing autographs at gate 10, taking pictures, and at gate 11, I'm just some fucking fat old man. You know, notice it like as I'm getting older. Like now, I see women helping me with my bag, like to put it in the overhead. I think, oh, that's what I look like now.
It is interesting because of the, I guess they call it the long tail of the comet, that anybody can be incredibly famous and you have no idea who it is. I always love walking.
Well, especially now with YouTube and all that.
Yeah.
You were saying you were walking what?
No, I was saying that when I used to live in L.A., we would always go to the farmer's market. I remember running into Jeff Garlin at the farmer's market. I think he was having lunch. Is it Bill Simmons, the sports guy?
I think so, yeah.
You're a big sports guy. I'm not a big sports guy.
Uh-huh.
I'm not interested in sports. Don't get me wrong, I love sucking cock, but...
I don't think that, you know, that's not one and the same.
I mean, anyway, so I sit down...
But didn't you, like, a half an hour ago say you didn't want to say a word, and now you're talking about sucking cock?
I didn't want to say what word?
Cunt.
What word again is that? I didn't hear
cunt.
You. I'm sorry.
Cunt. Listen to me. I said cunt.
Hang on. Are we losing him? I can't. What was the word? yeah. Bill Simmons. I guess it was Bill Simmons. I had no idea that I was talking to Bill Simmons. And Garland goes, "Boy, you were sure relaxed around Bill Simmons. God, you're as cool as a cucumber." I have no idea who you're talking about. So you can be, one of the things you can do is tell somebody you're really famous.
Well, that's pathetic, yeah.
I've done that.
You've told people that I'm famous?
I tell people I'm Dom Irrera. And they say, really? We remember him being a lot funnier. Let's plug some gigs, sir.
Plug some gigs. I'm at the... Where am I? Next week, I'm at the Austin Moon Tower Comedy Festival in Austin, Texas.
Wow.
Where I plan on killing. And the following week, I'm at the Black Box Theater, I believe it's called, in Delray Beach, Florida. Or Boca Raton, Florida. Three shows only. Get your tickets now. And go fuck yourself. Not in that order. I'm in... Then I'm in May, at the end of May, I'm at the Kilkenny Cat Laughs Festival in Kilkenny, Ireland.
That's magic.
You been there?
Yeah, I was there with you and Kathleen Madigan.
I thought you were there, yeah.
Yeah, you were like the mayor of Kilkenny.
God, that's funny.
Yeah, how are they doing over there, before you go?
Good. It's really, you know, it's hanging in there. It's, you know, I love going to that town. They call me the godfather of Kilkenny. It's so funny. After all these years, I mean, I've been going there. It always kills me, David, when they go, the press, like this scoop. It's so stupid. They go, do they get you in Kilkenny? I go, no. That's why I go back every year, because they don't get me. And it's so nice to hear my act in peace and quiet, all that interrupted laughter and applause. Just an angry Irish murmuring, I should have, for fuck's sake. Do they get you? What do you think if I go back every year? I'm telling you, this year they're going to get me.
Well, I love you, Dom. Thank you for doing this. I know how busy you are. And
yeah, I know. I have a lady that comes in here to turn me over so I don't get bed sores. I love you too, David.
I love you.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right, brother.
That's our show. Special thanks to Alonzo Bodden. Make sure to check him out. If you live in Nyack, New York, go to Levity Live tonight or tomorrow. Check out Alonzo Bodden. Dom Irrera coming to a comedy club near you, as is Kira Soltanovich. What a great show. Three great comics. Hey, give us a good review on iTunes. That helps. Subscribe to us on iTunes, please. Subscribe to us on Stitcher. Check out Pay What You Want. Go over to DavidFeldmanShow.com and pay what you want. Don't forget our show, April 29th at QED. Friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Most importantly, share this episode. Share the love. Share the laughs. Share the knowledge. From the Showbriz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us. Medicare for all. And for all, a good night.